experience unlimited at-bats from home, any season, anytime. See game speed pitches from more than 600 pitchers. Get ready for game time with game simulations. Face your friends in live competitions. And train like the pros with expert drills and metrics to track your progress. So when your moment comes, you'll be ready. Win reality. Baseball Uncaged.
Gary, I got the new Extreme Multiplier ticket. What's this?
I couldn't scratch these tickets with just your hands, so I multiplied them.
Gary, this is extremely weird.
Is it, Beth? Or is it extremely awesome? Now I can scratch for 50 times the winnings, 100 times. I designed this little hand special.
Couldn't you scratch them one at a time?
Maybe.
More winnings could be in your hands with the Extreme Multiplier Series from the New York Lottery.
When I hit 80, I needed help around the home. A friend of mine told me to call Freedom Care, and they'll pay my granddaughter to take care of me.
Funded by Medicaid, Freedom Care allows people to choose who provides their care, and the caregiver gets paid instantly after their shift.
Life is sweeter with her around.
Nana gave me so much joy as a child. Now it's my turn to return the love.
Call now to find out benefits and pay and how fast you can get started.
Everywhere but the seat. The seat is leather.
Alan, we get it. You love your bike. We do, too.
That's why we're America's number one motorcycle insurer.
But do you have to wedge it into everything?
What? I don't do that.
This reminds me of my bike.
The Wolf was about the size of my new motorcycle. Have you seen it, by the way?
Happy birthday, Grandma!
Really?
Look how the brush strokes follow the line of the gas tank.
Hey!
Brought my plus one. Jamie.
Welcome back to the show, everybody. Big Would You Wednesday. So the Would You part is over. Buster only very active today on Twitter or X. I'll read you some of the things. The most interesting thing heard at Met Camp yesterday, and it's not surprising, given that the Scherzer contract and others will melt off their payroll next winter, is that they fully intend to take a run at Juan Soto next winter. That's one thing. Second thing, World Series pick from here, Phillies over the Yankees. Phillies are very driven after squandering a great shot last October when they were the best team. As an improved defense, a healthy Harper, an ownership free agent committed to adding whatever is needed during the season. And finally, about Snell and Montgomery, Orioles have the need for a starting pitcher, and they are projected to have a payroll of just $100 million after years of spending nothing and hoarding cash. Be a great move for the incoming ownership. So Buster active today on X, and he's going to be active right now on the Michael K Show as our good friend joins us now. Buster, how you doing?
Michael, ready to go.
All right, let's start with the Soto stuff. So when you say they're going to make a run at Soto, does that mean that they're going to definitely outbid anybody? Or does Stearns act as some sort of a governor on Cohen that he's not giving the guy $60 million a year?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. That's going to be the big question, because obviously Cohen has the ability to step in and to blow everybody out of the water. As you know, when Yamamoto signed with the Dodgers, their offer was as big as the Dodgers' offer was. It was clear from how that played out that he wanted to play for the Dodgers. So the Mets are still, you know, big spending. The place where I'm wondering with Stearns and whether or not, you know, him being tethered to analytics is going to play out is in the Pete Alonso negotiations, because that position has not been paid. I think Soto's kind of a different discussion because of the type of hitter that he is, as opposed to Pete playing in a place where the last guy to get $200 million at first base was Miguel Cabrera, 8 years ago. It's a different negotiation. But I think your question is dead on, big picture, about where the Mets are going to go going forward. How much power does Stearns have? How much of it is driven by Steve's money?
Now, I just want to follow up one thing. There was always this rumor, I don't think it could ever be proven, that there's like this tacit agreement between the two teams. We're not going to get yours, you're not going to get ours. They didn't even sniff for Judge, and Judge could have helped that team. Do you think that agreement exists, or has it just been dreamed up?
I would not be surprised if early in Steve's tenure that he didn't necessarily want to play hardball against everybody. He wasn't worried about I do worry, think that he was worried, based on the conversation I've had with other owners, they perceived that he was a little bit worried about, offending other owners.
Especially the Yankees who supported getting him in.
Right, exactly. Well, Soto might be viewed as differently because he's not a homegrown guy, right? He's a one-year rental at this point for the Yankees versus Judge. I was surprised. I remember talking to you at that time saying Judge would have checked so many boxes for the Mets at that time. And, considering where the bidding went, he would have been a perfect target for the Mets. But based on what I heard yesterday at Mets camp, I think they're going all in on Soto.
How is it being received how the Mets are going about business this year in 2024? Does it make Cohen look bad? Make the Mets look bad? Or do people around Major League Baseball understand the plan that the next offseason is the better place to spend the money?
Well, I think that it's in keeping with how people perceive that he does business. And you guys, we all got a feel for that last year when he had that press conference in early July when the season was falling apart. And he basically was saying, I'm not going to sit here and just throw money down a hole. And they pretty much made the decision in July to blow it up and to move on. He's very rational. George Steinbrenner would have been at the other end of the spectrum. It would have been damn the torpedoes, full speed ahead, keep adding, taking on money. And the perception of Cohn is he's going to listen to, or he's going to follow what the numbers say. And you bring in David Stearns, who's really good with that, and he paid him a ton of money. He's the most expensive acquisition the Mets made during the course of the offseason. And so the feeling is that it's certainly at the outset, he's going to follow what David is recommending. I would say this. I think the Alonso negotiation is going to be a case where it's going to come down to whether or not Steve steps in and says, I get it. The numbers put us at X. But, Pete Alonso is a homegrown guy, and I think we should keep him. He's a power hitter, et cetera. If Alonso stays, it's going to be because of Steve Cohen.
All right, so
someone pointed this out to me. I was just going to mention, someone pointed this out to me, and I can't remember what year it was, but there was a season in which Chris Carter, playing for Stearns' Milwaukee Brewers, led the league in home runs, led the major leagues in home runs, I believe, and he was non-tendered.
Right.
And it was one of the first signs that we saw that, the first base position was going to be viewed financially differently than other spots.
Here's the thing I don't understand, and this is what angers Met fans when I say this. Let's say that Steve Cohen is Sandy Koufax, and he goes to Driveline, and he hires a pitching coach that wants him to throw right-handed. So you're taking away your best weapon. Sandy Koufax is left-handed. So, let's just look at the Yamamoto thing. If Steve Cohen wanted Yamamoto so much, why not offer him $400 million? Why are you bringing in a GM that's going to counteract the thing that you have an advantage over the entire sport? Why are you bringing somebody to tie your hands? I don't get it. Are you going to throw money around or not?
It's a fair point. And I have not talked to Steve, so I can't ask him, why not just blow it out of the water? You've got the money to spend. Why not just go there? And we've seen the Padres with the late Peter Seidler do that. I think the Phillies have increasingly been moving in that direction. Their feeling was, hey, we're going to keep Aaron Nola. We're going to keep Zach Wheeler. We're going to do whatever it takes. John Middleton's out there making it very clear that, he's going to spend whatever it takes. Maybe last year was for Steve part of a learning curve that you can throw a ton of money at it. You can add all kinds of stars, but there's no guarantee in what's going to happen. I just couldn't imagine that he would bring David Stearns in, pay him that kind of money. I mean, huge money, and then not listen to him. That would make no sense to me. So I think you at least have to wait for David to get started and before you start to just overrun him with money.
And the analogy I use, Buster, is just because I'm a billionaire doesn't mean I go into the market and I spend $1,000 for eggs. It does benefit Major League Baseball teams for being frugal, right? Because it does affect your international money. It does affect where you draft. He said he wanted to rebuild this farm system. So, yeah, he could throw a ton of money. And you know Buster better than anybody. You don't do this in a vacuum. If you throw a pitcher a ton of money that's never thrown a ball in MLB, then how much are you going to have to spend on other guys that have succeeded in Major League Baseball? I always hear general manager in every sport, I don't want to set the market. So I think sometimes it's bad business that even if you have the money, to just throw it around.
Well, and you're talking about someone who's made his, you know, he's made his life making money. He's not doing that by being reckless. And, you know, maybe, and I can tell you this, there are other teams who are involved with Yamamoto who are saying, yeah, we really like him, but the most attractive thing about him was the fact that he was 25. You know, to reach free agency at that age without much mileage on his arm, that would have been a sound investment. But there's also a feeling that there's going to be a learning curve with him, that it's going to take 2 or 3 years. I've had some teams tell me they look at him as being more of a number one, or excuse me, more of a number two, number three type starter than, you know, it's not like he's coming in to just beat Gerrit Cole right away.
All right, so we've got Snell and Montgomery available. The Red Sox might have not have Giolito. The Orioles have had injuries in their staff as well. It looks like for one of the few times, Scott Boris has really misread the market. You know, his two previous free agents took opt-outs and a lot less money than they thought they were going to get. What's going to happen with these two guys?
So from what I'm hearing the last couple days, that among the teams that have been mentioned, that the preferred destination among people who know Snell, they believe it's the Angels. That and the Angels have been talking with Snell. And you know, so we'll see, you know, if does that lead to something. The Angels have been really quiet this offseason after losing Ohtani. And so at some point, if I'm sitting here guessing today, then I'm thinking he's going to wind up with the Angels. The Giants have been mentioned as well. I just don't think for the Yankees and for the Mets, it makes a lot of sense, because you saw what happened with Bellinger and with Chapman. They wound up taking shorter-term deals, you know, one-year deals essentially with opt-outs. They're 3-year deals, but you can have opt-outs after years one and years two. If you're a team and you're going to invest the type of money where you're going to be taxed at 110% and you're going to give up draft picks, that doesn't make a lot of sense. On the other hand, you know, the Angels can do that with the sort of taxes that the Yankees would incur. And that to me is the team to watch on this one. With Montgomery, you know, the perception among some of his friends and teams is that his preference is to be, you know, in a smaller market like Texas, like St. Louis. I just don't know if those opportunities are there at this point. I know the Red Sox had interest in him. You guys know the connection with his wife in Boston, and, you know, maybe that would make some sense, and maybe the Red Sox have some insurance on the Giolito deal. All along, I thought the Red Sox on paper made a lot of sense, but I don't know what Jordan wants. You know, does he want to go to a different team? The Orioles are maddening in a way, because the team is amazing. Yeah, the group of young players is amazing. This is an opportunity for an owner who spent nothing and for incoming ownership to go out and to make a splash and get the sort of player they need for a team that has shortage in pitching. Their position players, tremendous, but they have a lack of depth with their starting rotation. They absolutely should be on one of these two guys. I think Montgomery would make a ton of sense for them. I just don't know if the owners would spend the money.
It's unbelievable what's going on there. It just doesn't make any sense at all. Let's move back to the Phillies for a second. Please tell me that the world has not gone upside down. Is there any way on God's green earth that the Phillies are going to give an extension to Bryce Harper, who has 8 years left on his contract? I mean, Scott would have the audacity to ask for it. Are the Phillies going to give it to him?
I think eventually they will work something out. I think that they're going to, you know, commit another $40 million a year for an extra 4 years? No. But I know Bryce loves playing there. He made up his mind he wanted to stay with the Phillies. Is it some sort of an understanding that he's going to finish his career and put some numbers to it that are, you know, probably going to wind up being more modest than what people realize because it's their end of his career? Yeah, I think so. We had a, you know, great conversation because we had the Mets on our broadcast yesterday with Francisco Lindor, and he noted that in the last couple of years, you're starting to see the sport, which, you know, contracts have gone out for guys 39, 40, 41, mostly from the Padres. You start to get the sense that the sport is retreating on age. And it's now more of a 20 to 36-year-old sport versus going into the late 30s and 40s. And the Phillies obviously would, you know, have to make some concessions to give Bryce that, you know, that extension. I don't think it would be as big of money as what he's making now.
Who potentially can be this year's Arizona Diamondbacks? And can the Mets possibly be in that conversation?
And, Don, I should add one more sentence. I would say this. Among all owners right now, John Middleton is that guy. He's the guy who is cost be damned. I like the player. I like my team. I want to keep this together. So we have to remember that when we talk about whether or not Bryce gets an extension. Don, can you repeat your question?
Well, who can be this year's Arizona Diamondbacks? And could it be the Mets?
Yeah, so I'm in the process of doing a poll of executives around baseball on a number of various questions. And, you know, and one of the questions I have is, who's the sleeper? And I'm getting back a lot of Mariners, and that's couched with, should we consider them to be a sleeper because they've been making the playoffs? Their pitching staff is loaded. They've made some nice additions in their lineup to fill in some of the, you know, for the offense they didn't have last year. And I'm hearing a lot from about the Cincinnati Reds, who loaded up this year. You know, and on the flip side, in terms of being a team, I mean, I think the Dodgers go into this year, like the Braves, just under enormous pressure. In fact, there are a lot of teams, it feels like, that it's, you got to have a great year or this thing, there are going to be major changes here. There's so much pressure on the Dodgers. You know, we haven't seen a team that's entering a season with the kind of pressure that the Dodgers have on them since those Yankee teams in, you know, 2000, 2001. And Michael will attest to this. That team, by the fourth year there in 2001, after they'd won championships, they were exhausted from that. And I do wonder if the Dodgers will be able to, you know, be able to shoulder that the entire season.
We're in the middle of the baseball update with Buster Olney, brought to you by Bet365. So you were at the Met-Yankee game at Port St. Lucie. What's the buzz among baseball people about Spencer Jones? Is, do they believe he's the real deal?
Oh, yeah. And I, you know, just because he went to the same school I did, I, you know, been hearing about him for years.
That's Vanderbilt for people I don't know.
Yeah, and he is such a phenomenal athlete. You know, yesterday an extra base hit, to watch him run, it was shocking. I mean, in some respects, it's a lot like Aaron Judge. When you see him move, it surprises you someone that big can seem that athletic. You know, I mean, as time goes on, we'll see, you know, where his strike zone is, and he's able to generate the sort of coverage. There's always the concern about the strikeouts for someone who's that big and has to, you know, handle that sort of strike zone. But there is a lot of buzz about him because of his power.
So there's no way, you know, we had a caller yesterday wanting the Yankees trade him for Corbin Burns, and I don't think the Yankees will trade this kid. So Dylan Cease, I can't see them parting with a guy. This guy could be the replacement for Soto if Soto leaves.
And Stanton, right?
Yep.
Potentially that the person coming in and potentially doing what you anticipated from Stanton, 100%. They are totally jacked up about him, excited about him. And the stuff that you heard yesterday about Soto from the Yankee people about how the players all, you know, stop and watch him take batting practice and they love his regimen. I really feel like that they're getting Soto and Verdugo at the perfect time. You know, both these guys have a lot to prove. They got a ton on the line this year. And I'm hearing this from people who know both of them. They really think the presence of Judge is going to help each one of those guys. You know, in Soto, in San Diego, there's the clubhouse thing. Where is he going to hit the lineup? That seems to have completely melted away. And I think Judge has a lot to do with that. And I think with Verdugo, too, he needs a teammate who, if he has a bad day, if he doesn't run out of ball, if something, you know, if he shows up a little bit late, he needs a teammate who's going to look him in the eye and, come on, man, you can do better than that. A peer and Judge is that perfect guy.
Do you think, Buster, that the Yankees made the trade for Soto? Now, Higashioka, obviously just a backup catcher, but four young pitchers, four young arms. Did they make that trade for 1 year, or do they truly expect to keep him? Because with Zach Wheeler getting $42 million a year at the age of 33, I mean, I'm sorry. Yeah. Soto's going to get $50 million a year. Do they think they're going to sign him?
So Soto's contract, I believe this because, as I say, I think the Mets are going to be involved, and I think the Yankees are going to be all in to get him. They obviously are, you know, have to be cognizant of how far they go beyond Judge because of what they paid him in the past. But he's going to wind up, I think, having a chance to surpass Ohtani's contract in terms of present day value. The $700 million, you know, figure with Ohtani, of course, is a joke. It's a mirage. His actual present-day value is $461 million.
Right.
And Soto has a chance to be at that number, I think, with these two teams involved, 100%. And it's up to him to have a big year. You know, I've told you guys before, when he started in San Diego, he started slowly. He wasn't completely comfortable. He acknowledged that as time went on. So he's already got that scar tissue. He already knows what that's like. I think he's absolutely poised for a huge year if he can stay healthy.
But the thing, Michael, with the idea of trading for him, believing you're going to have him long term, mm-hmm. guys, wouldn't that have been a mistake? You know he's going to test free agency.
Well, maybe they're just intent on outbidding everyone.
But if that were the case, wouldn't it have been better to not give up anything, ride through this year, and then you could outbid everybody when he becomes a free agent?
But I think following 82 and 80, this became a very important year to win.
Yep. 100%. Totally agree with you, Michael. So I totally agree.
If that's the case, then... I'm sorry, Aaron. Buster, go ahead. Because I want to ask about Aaron Boone.
They had to be all in. They had to make substantive changes, and they needed a left-handed hitter, obviously, and that guy is built for the ballpark.
So how much pressure is on Boone to win this year?
It almost speaks for itself, right? And what's interesting is it's not only Aaron Boone that it feels like that this year's a huge year. Last year of his contract. It's also last year Dave Roberts' contract. The last year of Alex Cora's contract. There's going to be so much managerial shakeup by the end of the year. I think it's going to shock you guys. Golly Marmol, the manager of the Cardinals. Skip Schumacher, who's regarded as this great up-and-coming manager. With the Marlins last year of his contract, I think there are a lot of guys under pressure.
Have you covered the Blue Jays yet in person?
I have not seen them in person this spring.
Because you're the guy that would have the guts to ask Mattingly, what are you doing with that beard?
Yeah, but you've known him forever. What did you text him and ask him?
Yeah, I guess I could. I don't want to hurt his feelings, you know.
Well, who are you to talk right now?
Yeah, I have a beard, Buster, because I lost a bet. He didn't lose a bet. He looks like he's 70 instead of like 63.
Remember when Letterman, you know, his show wrapped up, and the next time he saw him, he had that huge beard.
And I wonder about that too.
It's shocking.
Yeah, I wonder
totally
about that.
Shocking.
Yep. So you have the Yankees and the Phillies in the World Series. Phillies winning, right?
Yes.
That would be fun. Repeat of 2009. Yeah, I love it.
And the Yankees, as you guys know, you know, there's a lot of betting odds for them. It's surprising to me how low the Phillies are among favorites. This was a team that middle of October last year, they were the best team in baseball, and I think that regret over what happened is part of what drives them this year.
Great stuff, Buster. We'll talk to you soon. Thank you so much.
You guys.
That's the baseball update brought to you by Bet365. Whatever the sport, whatever the moment, it's never ordinary at Bet365.
I don't think Mattingly's beard's that bad.
First of all, he's an incredibly handsome guy. He's covering up that face. Me covering up my face, who cares?
Good idea. No, but I just don't think it makes him look that old. I have to tell you, though, and I think it's probably projecting, I do have a pet peeve of guys in my age range.
Right.
Growing out these big gray beards. It's like such a thing right now.
Well, I first of all, look at Tony Clark, the head of the Players Association. I don't get it. Please call that up. It's such a weird look. And to this moment, he's never really explained it. Why would Letterman grow that beard?
Does he still have it?
Does he think he's anonymous? He's not anonymous. You still know it's David Letterman.
How old is Tony Clark?
Tony Clark has got to be in his 50s.
Yeah, I don't know why people do it. Like, it's a trendy thing now, and I know we should all, like, be proud of
like Jock Vaughn. Why?
Yeah, I hate it. I hate, like in the case of a Don, where everything went white, it works.
It's like with Mattingly's beard.
And by the way, that's why I don't hate Mattingly's.
Yeah, Mattingly's nice.
But when you either have no hair and you're young, or you have a head of hair and it's not gray, but the beard grows in completely gray, maybe I'm self-hating on my aging. I hate it. I despise it. And when people are having, like, they're doing the beard.
Right.
But just here in the chin, they're getting two big, huge skunk spots.
Yeah.
But there's nothing wrong with some dye. Keep it dark. I haven't used it yet, but believe me, I will.
I'm thinking of going darker with mine, should I?
Why not?
Because it would look weird, because my hair is not that dark.
Well, it depends how dark. If you go black, if you know.
No, I go brown, the color of my hair.
I think it'll look nice. I don't know how you
could.
How hard is it to do? You just use a brush or something?
Easy. Just for men, baby.
By the way, we could all do it if Just for Men will give us some nice sponsorship.
Play for Mr. Gray.
I'm going to need it, though. I'm getting a little... When I put the glasses on yesterday, I saw a bunch of hairs.
I've got a question to ask you about the glasses, and it might offend you, but I'll do that when we get back.
Go ahead.
No, I'll do it when we get back, because I think it's a really... Don't take your headphones off when you have work to do. Don't even think about it.
Oh.
Don't even think about it.
Oh. Yeah, get to work.
And put your glasses on, too, so you can read.
Yeah. You know what? You're right.
Got to tell us about BetterHelp. And nobody does this better than you.
The Michael K. Show on Yes is presented by Untuck It. Shirts designed to be worn untucked. Shop now at untuckit.com.
At DraftKings Casino, we give credit where credit is due in casino credits. New players, sign up now and get a deposit match up to $100 in casino credits when you deposit $5 or more. Download America's number one online casino or play online today. And get a deposit match up to $100 in casino credits when you deposit $5 or more. DraftKings Casino, the crown is yours.
When my grandfather was diagnosed with mesothelioma, he didn't know which law firm to hire. His doctor gave him one name, his old union buddy gave another. But my grandfather, he did his homework and found Whites and Luxembourg. It was hard to find anyone who could match their experience, so the choice was easy.
Call Whites and Luxembourg today at 855-VERDICT. That's 855-VERDICT.
Okay, so Domino's Perfect Combo includes two medium one-topping pizzas, 16 Parmesan bread bites, 8 cinnamon twists, and a 2-liter of Coke. Today we're on the street asking real people how much they think it all costs.
All of it?
All of it.
$44, $45?
$34.99.
The two pizzas are probably 10 each.
$75. What if I told you that this Domino's Perfect Combo is only $19.99.
Shut the front door.
$19.99?
No. This will feed a family.
It's Domino's Perfect Combo, and it's all just $19.99.
Spring training is blooming on Yes, and we're your home for the Yankees with all the action from Steinbrenner Field. Watch the biggest names, the best prospects, and the newest Bronx star, Juan Soto. Yankees coverage continues tomorrow at 6:30 on the Yes app. Presented by Montefiore Einstein, the official hospital of the New York Yankees.
Within 15 seconds of logging onto social media, the algorithm has your daughter in its crosshairs. It sends her a steady flow of images telling her she isn't thin enough, pretty enough. They invade her brain, causing body dysmorphia, anxiety, depression, leading to the worst rates of eating disorders, self-harm, and suicide we have ever known. All while she's sitting right next to you on her phone. Congress knows, but it refuses to act. Don't let her suffer the secret pain alone. Use your voice. Demand a plan. Join us at the Center for Countering Digital Hate. ProtectingKidsOnline.org. Because it's up to you to protect your children from social media nightmares. Join us for her, for your daughter.
...96% of homeowners are overpaying for home repairs. Homeowners need to call Choice Home Warranty now. Studies show average homeowners are spending up to $6,000 a year on repairs for home systems and appliances. That's 10 times more than they should. Get all the protection you need with a plan through Choice Home Warranty on over 25 home systems and appliances. Coverage includes your air conditioning, plumbing, stove, washer and dryer, and more. Choice Home Warranty has a fast claim processing time, so your home doesn't skip a beat. With a large nationwide network of technicians, we'll begin the dispatch process right away to get your covered appliance fixed. Stop overpaying for home repairs. Protect yourself with a plan from Choice Home Warranty today. Call now for your free quote and get your first month free. 800-983-8523. That's 800-983-8523.
On FanDuel Casino, you can play hundreds of games, like Buffalo, Fort Knox Cleopatra, Rich Little Piggies, and more. And you'll get up to $1,000 back in casino bonus on any first day net loss. That's what you get with the number one rated casino app. Sign up for FanDuel Casino and get up to $1,000 back to play it again.
It's going to feel like home. It's going to be electric.
This is the Yankees flexing their muscles.
I think he's just going to elevate everybody in that lineup.
He has the right demeanor to pitch in the Bronx.
When you play in New York, the expectation is to win a championship.
This is the Yankees being the Yankees.
What if you went to your secret hiding place and found this? All drug use comes with risk. Before those risks become real, know that you can quit. For help with drug use, call 1-800-662-HELP for free and confidential information and treatment referral. Or go to samhsa.gov/knowtherisks.
Thing that could put Peter over the edge, but something I was thinking of, and I think it's something he has to answer. Peter, now that you have these new glasses, right, and you can see better, and you know where things are, and you can see things with clarity that you never saw before.
I do have to say, I think I may need new glasses for these lights, though. It's a lot.
Will you wear those glasses during moments of intimacy?
See, what is...
Who does that?
Well, if you can't right. see otherwise, no. you got to know where everything is.
It's a great point by Michael. I think it's a kind of cross the bridge situation.
Really?
Yeah.
Nobody wears.
That's not true.
How do you know?
Of course, people wear glasses during intimacy.
But when you base everything on porn.
No. If you're blind as a bat, you've got to wear glasses.
The whole fun is to feel your way around.
Oh.
I hear you, but if you're wearing, I mean, you
no,
could,
you're not doing
what
it.
What if you're
it's
already
ridiculous.
Wearing them? You have to take them off? Why would
right.
you take them off?
Do people take their contacts out during these things?
Yes.
They do?
They take contacts out during
these Yeah, I think it's because you're going
you're
to bed.
Out of your mind.
Yeah, but what if it's out of bedtime, Don?
You guys don't know what you're doing. You have no game. You think no, you do, but you don't.
Well, no. You in this case, you just said you made it sound like the only option is when you're going to bed. On your birthday. What about another time?
Come on. What are you wearing glasses for? What are you studying it?
Well, don't you want to see her face
do a three-page paper on it after?
You want to see like a look of discouragement?
Listen, we clearly go about things differently.
I think if you're wearing
touch, feel, taste, there's a lot of things that go into it. You want your eyes? What do you open your eyes during the whole thing?
My eyes are always open. Always.
Then you're a freakazoid. That's worse than sleeping with your eyes open.
No. You have to have your eyes open.
I just don't
the whole thing is visual.
So why don't have it lit? Have people come in. Have Yes come in and light
you know
the bedroom
what? The lights are always on.
You're just a freak, honestly. You are absolutely...
I completely play against Billy Joel's song. I did not turn
off the lights.
I don't turn the lights on.
Wait, are you saying that in... every like makeout you've ever had,
lights on.
Your eyes are wide open.
Always.
Oh, see, no. Hold on. I mean,
always.
In all seriousness,
yes. I'm being totally serious.
What's the
always.
Matter with you?
I like to see things. Yeah, I like to see the world.
That is so off-putting.
What is it
really
off-putting?
That really would be.
If I opened my eyes mid makeout and the girl was just staring at me, eyes wide open, I'd go,
No, I'm not necessarily staring, but my eyes are open.
The whole.
I want to take in all the senses.
I don't believe that's I don't know if that's true.
You know what?
Honestly,
some of my ex-girlfriends on the air, and they'll tell you eyes always
right,
open.
And they'll say that it freaked them out. It was disconcerting.
Yeah. Don, I like what you said there. You implied that no one reads.
You do got Dude, man, I don't know what to say. You're a freak.
No, he's a weird dude, man. There's a lot of weird stuff happening around here. We got Winthrop who thinks Do the Right Thing is a comedy. You got Michael. You got Winthrop who also says I don't like comedies. You got Michael who's making out with his eyes open every single time, the whole time.
Don't cheapen it. It's more than just making out. The eyes are always open.
It's such a bad look.
No, it's not. It's a terrific
look. No.
First of all, I have nice blue eyes. Why would you?
No, but in terms of how it sounds to other people.
And I have Klieg lights on, too. I love Klieg lights in the
bedroom. I don't know what a Klieg light is.
You know those things during big openings?
Wow. Yeah.
Like searchlight. Yeah. Searchlight. Yeah.
Wow.
You're just a freak.
So 22 years in, you're learning new things. Listen,
there's a lot of things that we can't say.
But you know what?
That I'd win the argument about you being a freak. But that was probably, believe it or not, Peter, this might be the most disturbing.
Believe me, we have this forever now.
So I guess because you just want to be all in, you'd have the reading glasses on. So your eyes are wide open
with the glasses.
Reading glasses
No. Because I can see from if I have to read words, I need the glass. But no, I don't have glasses on, Dora. But if I had to, I would. I'd have on. I have Kareem Abdul-Jabbar.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like if he needed goggles, right? If he needed glasses, and he's going to work. He would probably have to wear the Kareems because he doesn't want to have them fly off.
Can I? Right. Listen, you're more than welcome to talk about anything on the show. Call in. The first thing I'm going to ask you during those moments, are your eyes open? That's all. Let's start with Danny in Long Island. What do you think Danny's going to say?
Danny's going to think you're an absolute freak.
All right, let's see. Danny, eyes open or closed?
First of all, if you're about to do something and the female person you're with has to put on her glasses because she can't see, you have problems bigger than vision. If she needs to say, wait a second, I can't see that clearly.
And if she needs the Klieg lights, it's even worse.
Yeah, I can't see that clear enough. I may need my binoculars. You got issues. I wear reading glasses. The glasses are off. The eyes are closed. Absolutely.
Oh, dear, because you're not a deviant.
If you're making out with somebody, and I open my eyes, what am I seeing? Her eyebrow? Like, I need to have my eye open to see.
You know what, Danny? Can we give Danny point guard? Danny, let me tell you why Danny gave you the point guard. And Don, I don't think you were being specific enough. Throughout all of the events, your eyes are mostly open. But specifically when you're there for making out, your eyes go to closed. That's what you're saying. There's plenty of things to see, obviously. But your eyes stay open throughout each makeout? That's the weird part.
I also happen to have an interesting would you and a list for Don.
All right, go ahead.
Here's a would you to my sportscasters. You're stuck on the overnight for the rest of your career, but you make twice as much money as you're making now. You get to see every one of your children's events for the rest of their lives, but no more play-by-play. So you are now this crew now goes to the overnight. You get paid twice as much as you're making now.
No.
You get to see every class play, baseball game, hockey game, but you can't do play-by-play.
I'm in for the overnight.
I'm in for the overnight, too.
I'm out.
Okay.
Because he doesn't have a child. When you have Guadalupe, it's going to change.
I'm telling you, the one thing, and Danny, I'll let you finish. The one I love working and so proud to be on this show and on the afternoon drive, how significant that is. The one awful thing is I'm going to miss a ton of Marco and Jalen events. That happened like right after school, games during the week.
So
I'm going to miss out on a lot.
I know, but one thing
I'm very envious of Danny, it sounds like you get to go and see your sons play ball, and that's a major part of your life. And it was important for my dad to see me play. So it'd be a tough sacrifice, but if you did
the overnight, you'd be around to do more, but you'd also be a zombie a lot.
No, this would be right in my wheel.
When did you last do this, the crazy hours? You always, Don, Michael, have you ever noticed Don always says he's I'm up for early mornings, overnights. When was the last time you really did this? Because it is gut-wrenching, and you're older.
I loved overnights.
When you were how old?
Oh, I was my late 20s when I was doing overnights at the Fan. And I get home at 6:30, 7 o'clock, and I'd sleep until 1-2 o'clock in the afternoon. I had the whole day free. I loved it.
Okay, here's a list, Don. You ready?
Yes.
During my Richard Lewis morning, I was reading an article, and a 1972 New York Daily News article announced these five people as the up-and-coming comics. First of all, the guy who wrote the article talked about nailing it. Richard Lewis, Richard Pryor, Robert Klein, Andy Kaufman, and George Carlin, no relation to Chris Carlin. Make my list 1-5.
Well, real quick, when did he write this?
1972. Well, that's, or something.
He did quite well.
Well, Pryor would have to be one.
I would have Carlin one.
No.
Carlin one, Pryor two.
A reverse.
Lewis three. Kaufman four. And
who's the
Robert Klein five.
Robert,
would be
Robert Klein. I think you're giving him a little.
Listen, Klein is a preference.
Klein's a distant fifth.
No, but Klein was.
Listen, great.
He's great. Right. But in terms of the names and impact, he's five. I'm sorry.
He also did his comedy with his eyes closed.
Is that true?
You know what, Danny? I'm hanging up on you. Bye.
I'm thinking. You know, some of these things with your eyes open, like you like sneezing with your eyes open. You don't want your eyes to pop out of your head.
Well, right. What is the name of? Really? What's the name of the movie? Eyes Wide Shut.
Well, it's a freak. The movie's a freak show. Did you just ever see the movie?
Yeah.
The movie's a freak show because you're a freak show.
I'm not a freak show. I'm very normal. Let's see. JJ from North Carolina. He's got some bad take, but he's 22.
He's got a woman tied up in the bedroom.
JJ, eyes open or closed?
Absolutely disgusting, Michael. What is wrong with you?
So your eyes are closed?
Eyes open. I mean, Dan, what are you need the lights on? I mean, poor Jody. This is unbelievable. I mean,
no, this is all pre-marriage, okay? Anything I'm talking about is pre-marriage.
Yeah, post-marriage post-marriage you started closing your eyes?
No, they're still open, but I'm not talking about Jody.
Just because out of respect.
Right.
Right. Got it.
Definitely eyes closed.
You know what? You don't know what you're missing. You frankly don't know what you're missing.
What am I missing? Her forehead? The acne on her forehead?
First of all, you guys are taking literally the making out like you're just kissing. I'm saying throughout anything, the eyes have to be open.
But that, what?
Because so you could see everything.
Well, but I agree with you. I'm talking specifically about making out.
No, I was talking about any intimacy. I'm not just talking about making out. I mean everything.
No, but like there's so many different things you could be doing. Where there's distance, and thus it's normal to have your eyes open. But when the distance is completely closed,
still open,
face to face, that's when it's weird.
What else do you have, JJ?
I'm so off track now. What was I going to say?
Be a professional, damn it.
The Yankees. Sorry, the Yankees, because we know you love to take calls about the Yankees.
I do love. I think with my eyes open, I take them.
Exactly. With three, I think, big X factors here, whether they can make the playoffs or...
JJ's discombobulated right now.
He can't even pull it together.
Because I'm so disgusted by your, like...
No,
your
because you know what? I guarantee the next time, if it happens in the next couple of months, your eyes are going to be wide open. But please, go, JJ.
I think Rodon has to be great. If Rodon being the second starter turns into, completely injured and just can't throw the ball. I mean, today three earned runs again. I don't want to get all upset. But if he turns out to be a bust, this team might be bad. If LeMahieu turns back into the 2019 version, I think this could be, typical leadoff guy, him, Judge, and then Soto. Him getting on base all the time for those two guys would be amazing. And then I think Nestor, again, if Nestor turns into his all-star form, then you can have a top-of-the-line rotation with him, Rodon maybe, and then Marcus Stroman being the altering piece. And but if Nestor goes down again, then who knows?
Well, I made a list about a month ago. The key for me is Rodon. He had another bad game today, coming off that bad BP. Doesn't matter to me. Tell me what happens in Houston that first week. Number two is Cortez. They need Cortez to be the all-star that he was 2 years ago. DJ LeMahieu is important, because the whole lineup spills from there if he's leaving off. It doesn't have to be 2019 LeMahieu, just the second half of last year. Get on base about 38% of the time, we're good to go. But the pitchers are the most important. 1-800-919-3776. We move on with our eyes wide open right here on Yes and 98.7 ESPN.
We just shipped our millionth monthly coffee subscription box. We're sending custom thank you gifts to everyone on our team who helped us get there. I had to call Eric at Custom Inc. Custom Inc. has been with us from the beginning, and he makes sure that we get everything we need and even reminds us of our own company milestones. This milestone, though, I get to tell him about. He is every bit as excited as we are and knows great quality products we can customize and send for the gifts. Celebrate all your milestones with custom gear. Get started today at CustomInc.com.
easier way. From little fixes to big projects, taking care of your home is easy with Thumbtack. Download the Thumbtack app and start caring for your home today.
The next Mega Millions drawing is presented by Jackpocket. Jackpocket lets you order official state lottery tickets right on your phone. Just pick your numbers and place your ticket order. See a scan of your ticket right in the app. And get your winnings instantly. Go to jackpocket.com to get the app and get your first ticket free. Jackpocket, America's number one lottery app.
Home Chef's family menu is making it easier than ever to sit down and eat together. Our fresh pre-portioned ingredients and simple recipe steps are just a delivery away. Home Chef's family menu, solving family dinner one meal at a time. Get 18 free meals at homechef.com.
With ButcherBox, you never have to worry about what's for dinner. We deliver grass-fed beef, organic free-range chicken, humanely raised pork, wild-caught seafood, and so much more. Get high-quality meat sourced from trusted partners with free shipping always, so you can always be prepared and enjoy the important things. Sign up for ButcherBox today.
Hey. Hey. Rental?
Yep.
You?
Yeah.
You know, your shoe's untied.
Oh.
Don't let a boxy suit ruin your night. Rent from theblacktux.com.
Tired of pointless meetings?
So in this meeting, we're going to plan the next meeting to schedule other meetings.
There is nothing more pointless than unproductive meetings.
What about watching grass grow?
Nope.
What about pushing the crosswalk button repeatedly?
Nope.
What about bringing sand to the beach?
Nope. Thanks to ClickUp, now all of our communication and work is in one place. It allows our team to collaborate remotely and finish projects faster.
ClickUp, all your work in one place.
But is theirs worth so much more?
When the looks you love go for less, there's only one thing to say.
Oh, my Bob!
Bob's Discount Furniture.
Meet Hard Rock Bet with over 1,000 casino games. New slots added every month. Live dealer games like blackjack, roulette, poker, baccarat, plus fast withdrawals and 24/7 customer support. Hard Rock Bet has everything you expect from a top-rated casino app. And it has everything you don't. Download Hard Rock Bet, a top-rated casino and sportsbook, all in one app. Get free spins and more when you sign up now.
Diversity is in our nature. It is in nature, too. Biodiversity. It connects us and sustains us. But nature's biodiversity is at risk more than ever before. And the future of all life is in our hands. So what will you do? Love it or lose it?
It's go time in Brooklyn, and we got grit.
Mikal Bridges has got a highlight.
We got game.
Major flush on the Quacks attack.
We got goals.
Schroeder, does he have the hot hand?
Yes, sir.
Dan Thomas, a walking highlight.
We got Nets versus Pistons tomorrow at 6:30 on Yes and the Yes app.
I was diagnosed at 65.
37, earlier than most.
Every 9 minutes, someone is diagnosed with Parkinson's disease.
And every one of them can turn to the American Parkinson Disease Association. Visit APDAParkinson.org to learn more and show your support today.
It takes time. It's new.
You don't know the song?
I've only heard it a couple of times.
It's a wonderful song.
No, I agree.
The video is unbelievable.
You told me.
Oh, okay.
You told all of us.
I want to get Don and Peter's read on this, whether I'm getting soft. So...
Excuse me?
My credit card information was stolen.
Oh, no.
So they rang up about $4,000.
Wow.
In, you know, Fugazi charges.
I hate to hear this.
So one of the charges was like $2,000 for a jewelry place. Another one was $250 for a high-end steakhouse.
Okay.
Then another one was like a couple of hundred bucks for WeatherTech. You know, they make mats for cars.
Oh, yeah. Very familiar.
And then, like, $900 was for women clothing. And then another 200 bucks was...
200 bones, as the kids say.
Was for a ShopRite.
A ShopRite.
And I you know, I'm talking to the fraud people, and I almost want to let them have the... I mean, if they stole the credit card for food for their family, let them have it. But the other stuff, I want...
I don't think it works that way.
Oh, if I could say, I'll take the responsibility for that.
Classy by you. Classy by you.
Because I mean, if somebody's that desperate to feed their family, then you could have my $200. But the $2,000 for jewelry, I'd like to have your legs cut off.
Yeah, maybe they were going to sell the jewelry to buy more food for their family.
Oh, that's a good point.
Wow. It's thoughts like that make me the goat. You know what I mean?
I've never had a credit card information stolen. It's very violating.
Everyone's got to be paying attention, man. The people are active these days.
Let's go to Hakeem in the car. He's active. What do you think, Hakeem? Hakeem.
Hello.
Hello.
Hakeem.
Hey, Hakeem, the dream.
You there, Hakeem?
There he is.
Yeah, I'm here.
How you doing? Well, you're not doing that great. Yeah, let's go to Colin in Queens. Colin. Colin!
You know what is happening? I don't like it. I don't Something's like it. I'm not comfortable with it.
Let's go to Steve in the car. Steve.
How you doing, Michael? How are you?
Great. How you doing, Steve?
Good, good. Listen, I listen to you guys every day on the way home to Long Island.
Thank you.
You commented the other day about one of the worst trades Cashman made was taking on Donaldson's $50 million contract instead of just releasing Sanchez.
Right.
Another trade I think is right up there is when they traded Montgomery for Bader, and Bader was in a boot and was hurt. Now, Montgomery at the time, I believe, was like 3-1, maybe had a 3 ERA. What about that trade? Do you think the Yankees regret that since they're always looking for pitching?
I'll tell you why. I think they would make that trade 100 times out of 100 times. They don't get past they don't get past Cleveland. I mean, Bader hit 5 home runs. And they've never been... pitching's not been their problem. Yankee fans seem to have that issue that pitching's the problem, that they don't get ahead. No, it's not pitching. It's their hitting that goes south in the postseason. So they replaced Montgomery. Now, Montgomery turned out to be a player that, you know, ended up helping the Texas Rangers win a World Series. But anybody can have him right now. Nobody's bidding on him. So, yeah, they make that trade 100 times out of 100 times because eventually Bader got out of the boot. And they don't get past Cleveland and go to the ALCS without Bader. Yeah, they make that trade over and over. That's not one of his worst deals. Let's go to, what are you laughing about?
Someone posted a picture, a very unfortunate picture that was taken at one of our events recently. And I'll show it to you. And they wrote, "It's true. Michael keeps his eyes open. Don likes them closed," and sent this picture.
That's terrible.
No. Don't show that to
Don, you remember this photo, don't you?
I do.
Jeremy in Connecticut. Jeremy.
Hey, guys. How are you doing?
Good. Big how are you? Thank
watch
you.
You guys every day.
Thank you.
I got a couple things to say. I have the eyes open sort of thing. I just have to tell Michael, if you have to have your eyes open and know if she's having a good time, you're not doing it, right?
Oh, you know what?
No, my God. Hey, Jeremy, how could you? If you have your eyes closed, how could you see the good times?
You hear the good times.
How can I see the good times?
Yeah.
I don't need to see it. I'm hearing it. I'm feeling it.
Nah.
So I need to see
if you're doing it right. If you know what you're doing.
Visual is very important to me. But please go on, Jeremy.
Was it a confirmation of the kill?
Exactly. Please, Jeremy, go on.
I have a would you for Don, actually. I have a would you. Would he rather spend a whole weekend watching every stroke of a golf tournament?
Mm-hmm.
Or spend the equal amount of time watching on an endless loop a video of Nancy being intimate with all her ex-partners?
I mean, come on. He doesn't hate golf that much.
I think he does. Let him answer.
All right, here we go.
I would be consuming the golf. I mean, how could you?
Although Don and Nancy have been together some long, it probably wouldn't take that long. It'd be a much shorter time.
But some long, what is some that like? Long. Something like an order at a Chinese restaurant?
Oh my God. What's happening here?
A very old school Chinese.
What is happening here?
Yeah, you get that with the.
This is a Friday show.
It wouldn't be that long.
Spring training isn't just for baseball players. It's time for you to get into shape and ready for the.
Luckiest man on the face of the earth. Playing in Yankee Stadium is the best thing that could ever happen to a ball player.
Making that call as soon as I did.
Call Whites and Luxembourg today at 855-VERDICT. That's 855-VERDICT.
You know, when I take the bike out like this, all my stresses just melt away.
I hear that. This bad boy can fix anything.
Yep, tough day at work. Nice cruise will sort you right out.
When I'm riding, I'm not even thinking about my painful cavity.
Oh, you shouldn't ignore that.
And every time I get stressed about having to pay my bills, I just hop on the bike, man.
Oh, come on, man. You gotta pay your bills.
You don't have to worry about anything when you're protected by America's number one motorcycle insurer.
Well, you definitely do. Those things aren't related, so...
Ah, yee! Oh, that is a vibrating pain.
Spring training is blooming on Yes, and we're your home for the Yankees with all the action from Steinbrenner Field. Watch the biggest names, the best prospects, and the newest Bronx star, Juan Soto. Yankees coverage continues tomorrow at 6:30 on the Yes app. Presented by Montefiore Einstein, the official hospital of the New York Yankees.
Only 1 in 5 people with disabilities, including those with autism, are employed, despite many having the skill set and desire to work. Why? Outdated stigmas and beliefs. So let us make it easy. This is a job for someone with autism. This is a job for someone with autism. So is this. That job? Also perfect. Businesses value diversity, but sometimes overlook the unique strengths and abilities of the autism community. Introducing WIN, the Workplace Inclusion Now program by Autism Speaks. We bridge the gap and help businesses lead the way in inclusive hiring. Yes, these are all jobs for someone with autism. To learn more and lead the way in inclusive hiring, go to autismspeaks.org/win. Yep, that job too.
This spring is the perfect time to get away. With a great deal on your favorite Hyundai model. All backed by America's best warranty, plus 3 years or 36,000 miles of complimentary maintenance. Add more joy to your journey at the Hyundai Getaway Sales Event. Get in and get away now before these deals are gone. Lease an all-wheel drive Tucson for $229 a month. Or get 0% APR or up to $1,500 bonus cash. Hurry, offers end soon.
FanDuel Casino has your chance at the number one feeling, winning, which ranks even higher than the 18th best feeling, saving a kid from a well. 59 years later.
For the first time, new players get 200 bonus spins with your first deposit. Plus, get up to $1,000 back.
You know, the Jets right now are in an interesting situation. Who are they going to pick in the draft? Are they going to pick somebody for the future? Are they going to pick another quarterback? Well, after what Aaron Rodgers said on the Look Into It podcast, everybody has a podcast, maybe they don't have to pick a quarterback, Don. Did you hear what he said?
I did.
Let's listen. Let everybody hear. Aaron Rodgers, how long he wants to play?
You know, couldn't get to a top speed sprinting, but really been in a good place rehab-wise from the start and feeling really good. And, you know, again, I'm hopeful I can play two or three or four more years, but you need to have some good fortune there, too.
Two or three or four more years for A-Rod.
Okay.
You don't think he's going to play? Why not?
Four years?
Because it's not going to happen.
Brady did.
So he's Tom Brady. Nolan Ryan pitched. But so what? There's always
outliers. But this is one of the great players of all time.
Yeah, that already just came off of missing an entire season.
And Tom Brady missed an entire
season.
Said
he was going to try to come back.
20 years ago.
Yeah,
I know.
Come on. That was 2008.
Okay, but he missed an entire season.
Yeah, Tom Brady wanted to play till he was 50, and he didn't. Now, I understand the optimism, but he said things would have to go his way.
But wouldn't you agree that Tom Brady could have played till 50 if he wanted to?
I don't think he would have been nearly as effective. And
he looked pretty effective that last year.
They're just not the same.
Yeah, there's always outliers. There's Gordie Howe. There's Tom Brady, there's LeBron. Nolan Ryan, and what LeBron James is doing. Now, I understand he's going to be 41 years old and expected to play, and I wouldn't be surprised if he gets 2 years, but to double that, to go 5 years, that's...
No. It's a nice thought. And listen, you can put me on the montage, put me on the hater montage later of the person who's like, I don't think he can do it. I don't think he can do it.
Now you mentioned Tom Brady, right?
He'll have the Jets hostage for the next 4 years.
You know,
oh boy.
So you're looking at it in a negative way. Interesting that you take that tack.
So far, what else do I have to? What else can I do? Unfortunately,
I think he can play better. But the last time we saw him in a full season, he was okay, not great. Now you could say, well, he had the injured thumb, whatever. But is he trending? What was Tom Brady doing when he was 39, 40 years old, compared to what Aaron Rodgers has done?
He was winning Super Bowls, wasn't he?
Yeah, they won back-to-back MVPs, but then you started to see some warts in that last year in Green Bay. Now he comes off a year in which he's completely hurt. I understand the optimism, but yeah, you going to bet on it, Michael?
I wouldn't bet on it, but I don't think I would bet against it.
No, but I would openly bet against 4 years.
This guy is a freak, and he is so in tune with, like, keeping his body right, the same way Tom Brady was. I don't think he's not. But body right in terms of, like, you can't guard against an Achilles injury.
I know, but to me,
in terms of keeping your arm right and keeping your whole body healthy,
sure.
This guy's not eating cheese curds.
But I agree with it, but the cheese curds unfortunately couldn't have prevented what happened last year.
But that was a freak catastrophic.
But freak catastrophic injuries happen in football all the time, and I firmly believe they happen to guys who are older and more fragile more often. And no matter how good a shape he's in, he's more fragile.
Before
he got... I was worried. I did say many, many times, they don't have a backup. This is a classic car. Get yourself a backup. And the engine blew out on the first drive. How'd you like that?
That was pretty good.
I still worry about him. I hope I'm wrong. Man, we all wanted to see this guy play. I don't know if you know this. We had the Jets on our airwaves last season.
No more. We don't care if he plays or not.
Yeah, exactly. It doesn't make a difference anymore. But it meant a lot to us last year. I was rooting for it, and he just
they'll win the Super Bowl this year because they left.
That is a possibility.
Yeah. Now he won the MVP at the ages of 37 and 38. Then at the age of 39, the last year in Green Bay, again, the Packers weren't not a great team. They were eliminated the last day of the season. When they needed the win, they lost to Detroit, and his thumb was injured. But they finished 8-9, 26-12. 3,695 yards.
Not too bad.
But not too bad. And then we don't know what last year would have been. He got hurt. So now he's going to be 2 years removed, what for him was a very average season. So it feels like he might have been trending away from ever being the MVP guy.
I don't think you could say that, because the reason he had a subpar year is because his thumb was broken.
Well, that's what you hope.
Right.
But still, I mean, it was, you know, 3,695 yards, 26 and 12. Now, you hope that that's going to be better. We don't know. But now he's going to be 40, going to be turning 41 in December. All right, and he ends up having a big year, and that can answer a lot of questions. But, Michael, if he has a year that looks a lot like 2022, then you're going to tell me that somebody's going to sign up for two or three more years of that as he's starting to get deeper into the 40s?
I mean, compared to the quarterbacking that the Jets have gotten of late, yeah, they would sign up for 2022. For the next two, 3 years.
We got to see what that looks like.
I mean, with the Jets' defense, and if he has that kind of year where he's thrown for 3,600 yards, yeah, I think they do it.
But now you're talking about playing, you know, two, 3 years after that.
Well, he signed for two more years anyway.
Well, listen, he might stick around, but I don't know, will he be able to stay upright? Now, you look at Brady, and you mentioned, Tom Brady at 40... threw for 4,500 yards, 32-8. And then at 41, 4,300, 29-11. You know, and then you're talking about over 4,000 yards at 42, almost over 4,500 yards at 43 with 40 touchdown passes. I mean, is he trending towards doing that? I mean, Tom Brady's a freak. Now, they all are conditioned.
But he was trending doing that the two MVP years.
The two MVP years, but we're talking 37 and 38. At 37 and 38... You know, at 38, Brady led the league in touchdown passes. And then the year before that, 33-9 for 4,100 yards. So the point is, Tom Brady's Tom Brady. You know, Nolan Ryan's Nolan Ryan, Gordie Howe's Gordie Howe. Is Aaron Rodgers there? Or is Aaron Rodgers a guy that, yeah, he might be able to stick around, but is he going to be... Because I don't think Aaron Rodgers is going to hang around and be a pedestrian quarterback. I think he wants to be an elite quarterback.
He has a gigantic ego, as most great players do. So he's not going to be pedestrian. Right. Then
think about the gigantic ego.
But he's saying three or four years, he wants to be great.
Right, and Tom Brady wanted to play till he was 50.
But he would have. I think it was from family obligations that took him out of it. He played very well last year at the Bucs.
I just think that when you're sitting there and you're going to be 41 years old at the end of the season, it could be optimistic. I want to play three, four more years. It's not realistic. Now, if you say you don't want to bet against it, fine. But you said you wouldn't bet on it. Odds are really against him. Now, he's going to do everything he can to make it happen, but it's going to be really, really difficult, Michael. I mean, everybody wants to play.
But this guy is a physical fitness freak. He's not like George Blanda.
Well, no, but I think it's still a sport in which there are, even though there are limitations of what a defense can do to a quarterback, they still are out to stop you, to tackle you. Mm-hmm. It is still a rough sport.
But it's the best time to be a quarterback in NFL history. You can't be touched.
True.
Listen, the fact is we're mostly going with hunch here and the information that we have. Don and I are looking at the information we have. The information over the last couple of years does not indicate that he's going to be Tom Brady.
But you can't say that because the last couple of years have been impacted by injury.
Those injuries are what we're talking about.
But before he hurt his thumb, again...
hurt his thumb.
I get it, but that's not because he wasn't in shape or he was
old. Not about being in shape. But how do you know it's not because he was old?
But the year before, the 2 years before, he won MVPs. So he dropped off a cliff?
It's not a cliff. Michael, I'm 44. When I was 41, I could see perfectly. I'm now blind as a bat. I mean, these things just happen.
Yeah, but you don't take care of yourself like him.
What am I going to do?
Jacob's Pickles every day? I mean, that's not healthy.
How many carrots can I eat to keep my eyes good? Don, what I'm trying to say is things just happen. I got into a big argument the night of the Rodgers injury because he went, that has nothing to do with his age. It's just what happened. All right, you say so.
Who said that?
Ballard. It
might have something to do with his age.
I believe it did.
Yeah, I mean, everything is older.
Everything is older. And what I'm saying is, over the last couple of years, we've seen everything be older, and he hasn't been quite the same guy. He had a slight injury 1 year, a catastrophic injury the next year. Unfortunately, to me, the way this is trending is, he's never playing a full season again. He will never play a 17-game season. I would bet almost anything.
And here's the... Because I remember a conversation that we had years ago when Jeter got his 3,000th hit. You're like, this is going to hit 4,000. And I said, no, Michael, because that's almost impossible to do. And you ended up almost looking right because he continued to play well. And he had 216 hits at the age of 38 in 2012. But then he got hurt in 2013, and then it never came back. And then he was done. How is Rodgers going to respond to getting hurt at this age? Tom Brady missed an entire season in 2008. He was a spring chicken compared to what he ended up being when he decided to retire. Now you're talking about a 40-year-old missing an entire season. This is what ends up happening. And I think it's really hard to determine whether he's just going to be able to find it again at this advanced age. We all think that you slowly and gradually finish. But sometimes at a certain age, you do go from MVP, 200 hits, breaking records, to all of a sudden the next year you get hurt, but and then you never find it again. That's why it's really curious to see what he can do here.
I think after the Jeter 200 hits, then he break his ankle the next year, right?
And then he never recovered. So he broke his ankle. Aaron Rodgers tears his Achilles. Mm-hmm. Like, so how will he bounce back? If you're 27 years old, yeah, you bounce back. It's no problem. But at 40, Michael, after missing the entire season, this could be the line of demarcation.
But one of the most desired free agents on the market is a guy coming off an Achilles injury at the age of 35, Kirk Cousins.
Yeah, so. But that's just out of the necessity.
But they're not going to throw $40 million, $50 million at a guy just because you need a quarterback. They've got to think he can play. They
right, but
he's also
35 and not 40, and he's not. And Aaron Rodgers, is Aaron Rodgers going to want to play at a limited level?
No.
Like, see, that's the other aspect of it. If Aaron Rodgers is going to play like he did in 2022, which was kind of a pedestrian season for him, he's going to hang it up. He's not going to want to. He's got nothing. Unless he wants another Super Bowl, he's not compiling. There's nothing he's trying to reach. He wants to play an elite level, and you think he can 3-4 years. Do you think he wants to be a backup? Do you think he wants he will struggle on a bad team or get beat up and throw for 2,500 yards, more interceptions than touchdowns just to say he's still playing? Or we're going to get to a point where if this year is a lot like 2022 and the next year he can't stay on the field, he's going to retire. Well, as much as he wants to prove people wrong, he wants to say, I can play an elite level. And that's going to be tough to do.
He's definitely playing 2 more years. No matter, I mean, he gave up all his money last year. To get his big money, he's got to play this year or next. And you can say, well, it doesn't matter. He's got a lot of money. Always matters. It matters to Warren Buffett. It matters.
That's how it always seems.
So I think he's sticking around at least for 2 years.
Two?
Yeah.
I think it depends on what happens this year. If he gets hurt again.
Now, that gives him another reason to come back. Now, if he plays is pedestrian, a different story.
Let's say he goes out there and plays okay, throws for like 3,200 yards, 25 touchdowns, 10 interceptions. The Jets go 9-8 and miss the playoffs. Is he going to say, I'm going to come back again, or is he going to look at it and go,
comes back again?
I don't know, because now you might come back now at 42, and now it looks like a disaster.
I think he comes back again.
He might. But then does he want it to end? Now it's not ending on his terms. It might end being carted off. It might end because nobody wants you because you went out there and proved you can't do it anymore. Again, I can't get inside his head. He doesn't strike me as somebody that wants to go out there and be bad but prove everybody wrong and say, well, I'm still in this league. Why is his name escaping me? The pitcher who pitched till he was like 47. He was a Philly. Rocky.
Jamie Moyer.
Jamie Moyer. Yeah. He actually went and had like Tommy John surgery at like 45. He just wanted to play. But he wasn't really that good. But he wanted to show that he could still play. He had to tear the uniform off. Is that Aaron Rodgers, or does he want to play an elite level?
He wants to play at an elite level.
Now, if you tell me he wants to prove everybody wrong and play 3-4 years, regardless of how he plays, that's one story. I don't think he's going to want to do that.
Speaking of New York quarterbacks, let's go to Daniel Jones. Lewis Riddick was on Get Up today. And he ripped the Giants and their treatment of Daniel Jones. Here's Lewis.
13 months ago, their owner, John Mara, said, we've done everything we could. We've done everything in the world, everything possible to screw this kid up in terms of the structure that they put around him with the coaching staff, the support he had on the offensive line, the support he had at the skill positions, all of it. And then just, you know, in March of last year, almost to the day, they gave him a contract. He played 6 games this year. He was sacked 30 times. Their pass block win rate's in the bottom quarter of the NFL. Andrew Thomas missed time this year. John Michael Schmitz missed time. Evan Neal is still a work in progress at right tackle. Darren Waller, who they signed, didn't pan out for them in the way that they hoped. They have no weapons on the perimeter, and now all of a sudden, now they're done. On top of the fact that now Brian Daboll has gone from being a coach of the year to having turmoil throughout his staff, people leaving, people wanting to leave, and now maybe, you know, the speculation now is about whether or not he's coaching for his job. Isn't that amazing how stuff can turn on its head? And you wonder why the Giants have not been able to make some headway right now in the East and be true contenders. Because when you have this kind of thing that is happening within one calendar year, there's no way you can make headway.
Well, I said this yesterday, all due respect to Lewis Riddick, all of these coaches lost their job because Daniel Jones didn't step up and was not great. Now, you can say whatever reason, and Peter said this yesterday, too, and I truly believe it. Yeah, you need a good offensive line. There are quarterbacks that get past it. They get past it. They get past an offensive line that's not great.
They show something.
He has never been great.
But they haven't done him any favors.
I get it, but for the sixth pick in the draft, has he ever shown you flashes of greatness?
Well, no. He shouldn't have been the sixth overall pick.
His first game, Michael.
Yeah, first
against
game.
Against Tampa Bay.
His first game ever, I was like, uh-oh.
But there's so many things being said there. You cannot tell me they've done. Now, I don't think it's been intentional by any stretch, but where John Mara has failed is the constant coaching changes. It looks like they finally have stability. Gettleman left this team in an absolute mess. I don't blame Joe Shane for where they are right now. Sure, he's made his share of mistakes, Michael, but they're still trying to get up from the mess that Gettleman left them, and that takes time. But I don't think that you've seen the best of Daniel Jones based on the offensive line, based on the lack of weapons. And when they did have some competency in that first year at Dable, he played pretty well. They got him in the playoffs. They won a playoff game. Now, you could like Daniel Jones, you can hate Daniel Jones, but you at least have to give me the fact that the grade has to be somewhat incomplete based on that they have not helped him. Yeah, you haven't seen greatness, Michael, but when should you have seen greatness? Who, outside of Saquon Barkley, who doesn't play every game, what great receivers have they had? What great tight end have they had? They've had a makeshift offensive line for years now, going back to Gettleman spending all that money on Solder. Right? Eli Manning was awful. Now his replacement looks awful because the offensive line has been terrible. There's been a lack of weapons. So it's been a mess there for Daniel Jones. You haven't seen greatness. When should you see greatness?
Well, you know what? He didn't make Darren Waller look that great, even though he was hurt a lot. When he did play, they never got him the ball.
Now, Waller's a mess. He's been hurt. Now he's contemplating retirement. I mean, that was not a great signing. Peter had that right on the screws the day that they signed him. And that's your big weapon. Team has no weapons. But by the way, they had no weapons when they went 9-7-1 and made the playoffs. And they're big. Hey, look at what we got. Was Darren Waller, and oh, we've got Sterling Shepard coming back. That's what they did in the offseason.
Then the speculation was, would Waller retire after one unproductive season? Turned out great.
But he's not going to retire either. I love that he's contemplating retiring. He's got money coming to him. People don't leave money on the table.
Rarely.
Very rarely. But
now he's, again, I feel like I'm always defending him, saying that I think that he's great. But in a year where they didn't have a lot of weapons, Michael, he threw for 3,200 yards, 15 touchdowns, ran for 7 more, got him in the playoffs. And then last year was an utter disaster because everything seemed to fail the Giants last year. You think Daniel Jones is a major reason why they stunk last year? Or was the fact that they couldn't protect him? You see how many times he was sacked? He was beaten pillar to post last year.
Yeah, I think he was a reason. I mean, I listened to Carl Banks, who said, you know, he said his opinion changed. He was very jumpy in the pocket.
Well, he was jumpy because he didn't have any protection.
Okay.
You don't lose 40-0 at home and say that it's all on the quarterback.
I'm not saying it's all.
Their defense couldn't stop anybody.
I'm not giving him a pass.
I don't think we're giving him a pass, Michael, but I think that we are trying to judge what he can be. If you can get an offensive line,
if
you get him some weapons.
5 years in, it's too long to judge. You've got to overcome obstacles. He hasn't. He hasn't. The injuries stink.
Well, but you don't think he overcame an obstacle in 2022 and got him to the playoffs? Well, that team was not very good.
Okay, but, you know, their defense was pretty good. They had an innovative coach and all that, and Saquon had a good year.
Yeah, but they also didn't have a great offense. They didn't have a lot of weapons.
You think they ran to the playoffs and his 16 touchdowns, or however many he had?
No, but it was 15 touchdowns. He ran for 7. Okay, he threw for 3,200 yards, and he ran for 700 yards. A lot of quarterbacks don't run for 700 yards and 7 touchdowns.
His record is 22-36-1. 22-36-1.
And the team has been brilliant. And they've gone through 3 coaches, 3 offensive coordinators,
and maybe
2 general managers.
All these coaches because he hasn't lived up to his promise. I mean, if Rich Eisen, if what he's saying is true, what are they saying? They're done with him. Buyer's remorse. From what? Because they don't think they've given him weapons? Or they're just done with him? They see through it all. He's not that great.
Well, I think because of the injuries. Well,
then why would they?
You know what he's doing? Don is, he's defending Daniel because there are valid reasons to say he hasn't gotten a fair shake. But it doesn't change to me the overall argument Michael's making, which he has yet to show he's the guy. He's yet to show that he's truly special. He has not done that thing that has allowed you to go, no, no, I see. We can literally count it, Madonna. The one comeback game against the Redskins in overtime, his first game against Tampa Bay. But overall, watching game after game after game, week after week, even if the odds were stacked against him, the guys, when you know they're your forever franchise quarterback, don't they find a way to show you over 4 years? Where you know?
Well, we know that he wasn't deserving of the sixth overall pick. We know he's not an elite quarterback. But to say you don't see anything special, how could you? You don't think you saw something special? That 2022 team was not very good. I mean, take a look at their wide receivers. And that, you know, Bellinger was their tight end. Slayton, Hodgins, Cager, Shepard, Sills.
It's bad.
You know, not great. You know, Saquon had a really good year. Rushed for 1,300 yards and 10 touchdowns. All right? You know, not a great offensive line. Daniel Jones threw for 3,200 yards. All right? Not, wasn't overly impressive. 15 touchdown passes. Didn't throw a ton of picks.
The problem,
and seven rushing touchdowns. Got him into the playoffs.
But the problem is, Don, we are talking about a league where now at this point, whether it's unfortunate or not, he hasn't done enough, and maybe he will go somewhere else and have weapons and be good. But if you're in a position where you're trying to make the decision, he hasn't done enough. You got to move on.
And what Jordan said, Jordan Ronan said, if you're Joe Shane and Brian Daboll, you're tying your career to this guy?
Instead, would you rather tie your career to this guy or give it a shot with someone new and tie your career to them?
But I think both can be true. The injuries scare me. I probably have to move on. But I think you can make the argument, have we really gotten a chance to see how truly good this kid could be?
Well, probably not under the circumstances. Let me ask you a question. If he had never been injured, no neck injuries, and the knee injury never happened, would you tie your future to him from what you've seen?
No, I would see it play out this. If he were healthy, I would let things play out this year to see where it goes. I have an out at the end of the season, but I'm paying him $40 million a year. I might still want the insurance policy of a quarterback because I have the out at the end of the year. But, hey, 5 minutes ago, I gave the guy a four-year contract worth $40 million a year. There obviously was something they liked about that 2022 season, and they want to be able to improve on it.
But even then, they seemed so half, no, you listen, know,
and,
with
and that's
it.
True. And again, I'm not selling you that he's Tom Brady. But I'm selling you that it's over and he's not very. You've got people like Mel Kiper says, I think he's a good quarterback. And well, then Reddick is basically saying the Giants haven't done him any favors. All I'm saying is the Giants haven't really given him a chance to see truly what this kid can do. And you can look at it and go, Michael says he hasn't seen greatness. Well, Pat Shurmur. Was Pat Shurmur fired because he couldn't Daniel Jones got him fired or because he just wasn't a good head coach? Joe Judge was not a good head coach. He was in over his head. That was proven. And they wanted to bring him back, and he embarrassed himself against the Commanders, taking a knee at the 5-yard line. That's why he lost his job, not because of the play of Daniel Jones. And then they finally get a competent head coach in Daboll, and what happens? He puts together a decent season, they make the playoffs. And then this year, nothing. Everything fell apart, including his own health. You want to give up on him? I've got no problem with that. I'm just saying, you can't tell me that we've seen truly what this kid can do.
I think, honestly, I know it's not good talk radio. I think that's it, though. It's both. You're right, Michael. They kind of do have to move on because he just hasn't shown enough.
5 years.
And they have to make a decision. Then you're making a decision. And to Don's point, though, can we say we truly got a good look at him? Not really. This team has been horrible.
The best thing that happened to Daniel Jones, it's like your house is run down, but right next door is a shack. He's played next to a shack in Zach Jets. Wilson, so he doesn't look that bad. And but that sixth pick, and Don's light, he's right, shouldn't have been the sixth pick. It's a failure. 5 years in, we don't know if he's a quarterback or not. That's a failure. That's not the sixth pick in the draft. You've got to establish yourself quicker.
I agree. But when you name those receivers that he's had and how horrible the line is, you think about what game one was against Dallas this year. This is a team that really has barely given him a chance. And when they gave him half a chance, they did get to the playoffs and win a game. So you can't take that away from him. I'll tell you how he lucked out. He may have. We'll see what they end up doing, because I know everyone now is saying, "Oh, they're done." Blah blah blah. We'll see. Don, winning those couple games, going on that little run, the Tommy DeVito run, that may put the Giants in a different position where they're not comfortable draft wise. If they end up not winning those games and they're drafting where the Commanders are drafting, right. I think this conversation is over. We're talking about Jaden Daniels or Drake May, and they're moving on.
I think you said it's bad sports radio. Both are true. As much as I'm defending Daniel Jones, I do see you're going to have to kind of create an exit strategy. It happened. They screwed up. But I would look at Daniel Jones and say, I would not be surprised, as we've heard people say, that if I plopped him on the San Francisco 49ers,
he could be fun.
You would see a quarterback that would take a team to the playoffs and make a run.
Well, I mean, could see it too. I think if Sam Darnold played instead of Brock Purdy, they would have gone to the Super Bowl last year. That's a special.
I think it's a very similar conversation. I still believe Sam Darnold's a good quarterback. I think the Jets ruined him. And the Panthers probably contributed to it as well. I do think that if he played a full season with the 49ers, he'd be better.
All right, we'll come back, take your phone calls. Kayla Greco Rosenberg and you on Yes and 98.7 ESPN.
The Michael Kay Show on Yes is brought to you by FanDuel. Make every moment more.
Hey, so I found a betting system that's really working great for me.
So did I. What's yours?
I set up an hour a week time limit on FanDuel. I can also set up wager limits, so I only bet what I can afford, and betting stays fun.
Right.
So what's your system?
What's that?
Your system. What's your system? What is that?
Every bettor has a system. Make FanDuel's responsible gaming tools a key part of yours.
I'm former Major League pitcher Andy Pettit. I teamed up with Tunnel to Towers after seeing their life-changing work with military and first responder families. Now we're expanding our mission to help veterans struggling with homelessness. We want to help them rebuild their lives not only by giving them a home, but by providing the services they need. Please join me in donating at T2T.org.
When I hit 80, I needed help around the home. A friend of mine told me to call Freedom Care, and they'll pay my granddaughter to take care of me.
Funded by Medicaid, Freedom Care allows people to choose who provides their care, and the caregiver gets paid instantly after their shift.
Life is sweeter with her around.
Nanny gave me so much joy as a child. Now it's my turn to return the love.
Call now to find out benefits and pay, and how fast you can get started.
96% of homeowners are overpaying for home repairs. Homeowners need to call Choice Home Warranty now. Studies show average homeowners are spending up to $6,000 a year on repairs for home systems and appliances. That's 10 times more than they should. Get all the protection you need with a plan through Choice Home Warranty on over 25 home systems and appliances. Coverage includes your air conditioning, plumbing, stove, washer and dryer, and more. Choice Home Warranty has a fast claim processing time, so your home doesn't skip a beat. With a large nationwide network of technicians, we'll begin the dispatch process right away to get your covered appliance fixed. Stop overpaying for home repairs. Protect yourself with a plan from Choice Home Warranty today. Call now for your free quote and get your first month free. 800-983-8523. That's 800-983-8523.
Teachers are dynamic leaders, shaping a new generation, innovating to prepare students for our fast-changing world. They're skilled experts, discovering a universe of solutions, telling stories, inspiring, mentoring, connecting cultures, leading by example. Teaching is a journey that shapes lives. Are you ready to begin? Explore teaching at teach.org.
Today, I consider myself the luckiest man on the face of the earth.
Playing in Yankee Stadium is the best thing that could ever happen to a ball player.
This uniform on.
World champions, team of the decade.
There it goes.
The Yankees are back on top.
Congress invites you to visit the revamped Veterans History Project website, where firsthand accounts shared by U.S. military veterans are accessible to the public. Performing a search of the collection is easy. First, go to loc.gov/vets. Click Explore the Collections. Scroll down to Search the VHP Collections and click. Make sure you're searching this collection, and with simple keywords, you can find what you're looking for. Visit loc.gov/vets today.
Sarah, you've got this, okay? But they lost.
Not really. Not where it counts.
Sure. Rangers made a deal. Let's talk about that. Is it enough? Does it move the needle a bit?
The fan base probably doesn't look at it at moving the needle. It's a guy that's got 9 goals and 25 points.
That's 9 goals more than me.
Well, and it's also 5 more than Brodzinski and Gaudreau combined. So to be able to put him at the third line center, Brodzinski plays the fourth line center. You can move Gaudreau to wing, just have depth at center. You're better off. He can win some faceoffs. He can good on the power play. He's got 10 more points to Brodzinski. He's got, Gaudreau's got 8 points. They've improved at center, which is a very, very important thing. Like baseball, hockey's about up the middle. Center, defense, goal. And so to strengthen your center is very important. Is it enough? I still think there's another move that needs to be made. They've got 48 hours in which to do it, or I guess it's down to 46 now. It's 3 o'clock on Friday. They've got about slightly under $4 million of cap space to work with, 3.8, 3 point something, depending on what they do with Rempe and Enstrom. They might be able to send them back to Hartford if they wanted to, although I think sending Rempe down might be a bit of a mistake. But I think there's still more to do. But Wennberg might not be sexy, but he's a nice player. He's a very good center. It's certainly an improvement. If you're able to acquire a third-line center at this stage of the season, that's a good thing.
Getting back to Jones very quickly, somebody sent me this clip from the draft the year that Jones was taken, and Todd McShay, who no longer is with ESPN, he said, these are his words, I see a backup quarterback in the NFL. I've taken a deep dive on 15 quarterbacks in this draft. He's 15th in terms of processing information. I don't think he's going to be very good.
Yeah, but we could go through. You bring up
Mel Kiper Jr. still loves him. Well, a guy that we also respect didn't like him coming out. That was before the injuries, before no offensive line, before no weapons. He said, "I see him as a backup quarterback."
Well, doesn't Orlovsky hate him too?
You think he's only a backup quarterback?
I'm saying, I
can't justify. I can't justify the pick at 6. No, and it wasn't this regime that did it. But can I see a good quarterback? Yes, I could see a good quarterback. I don't see an elite quarterback. You heard Jordan Ronan yesterday say that they're not all in on building around Daniel Jones because at some point you're going to have to move on. You built the contract to where you can get out this year. So is anything going to happen this year, guys, that it's going to make you say, I'm good having Daniel Jones for 2 more years at $80 million? And the answer is probably no.
No,
you're going to have to exit.
If they don't pick a quarterback in this draft and they just take a veteran guy and the Giants win 10 games, go to the playoffs, then they probably take the next 2 years.
But I don't think at this particular moment you can bank on him having a great season and then being committed to him for 2 more years.
But you just said, you have to draft a quarterback. If you don't draft the quarterback, there is something.
But do you really think they're going to be in a position, Michael, not to draft a quarterback?
I could see them in a position not to take it with the 6th pick. I could see that. And then what are you going to get with the 2nd round or 3rd round pick of a quarterback? It's a flyer.
No, but the idea would be to trade back into the 1st round to get the pick. So it's either take the quarterback at 6 and maybe overspend draft capital-wise on one of these quarterbacks that could go in the 1st round, or try to trade back in. I think they've got the draft capital to trade back in, go for Knicks, Penix, or just hope McCarthy falls. But it sounds to me, everybody's so hot for quarterbacks, I think all these guys are going to be gone before you get to, like, pick 14 or 15. And
so I think if you're going to get a quarterback that's going to make a difference, you have to take it with the sixth pick or move up. And who in the first three picks is going to leave? The Commanders need a quarterback.
That's right. We sure do.
They're not trading out.
Right. And
the Bears aren't trading out.
The Bears aren't trading out. The question is, I don't think New England's going to trade out. They're
right,
not going
to move
forward
with Mac Jones.
So the question becomes, do you take J.J. McCarthy at six? Now, there's some people in these mock drafts that think he can go as high as 10. Now, if you are, you weren't impressed. I certainly wasn't overly impressed either with his college career. He looks like a late first-round pick to me. But if you're hearing that he could go as high as 10, so is it that crazy to think the Giants would take him at 6?
Yeah, but, you know, you don't want to get hoodwinked because the Gettleman heard that somebody was going to take Jones with the eighth pick if he didn't take him. And we'll never know.
Well, listen, Gettleman was obviously in over his head, right? I mean, he was a nice scout, but he wasn't a great general manager. That was proven out. He made a mistake taking Daniel Jones. He probably should have traded down. But to his credit, he was in full bloom love, and I think if you love a quarterback that much, you shouldn't care what anybody says. It's your job that's on the line. Pick him. I don't know how the Giants feel about these quarterbacks. For all I know, Shane looks at McCarthy and thinks he's the next great quarterback. Then if that's the case, then take him at 6. Don't care what other people think. But if you're just taking a quarterback for the sake of taking a quarterback, Michael, that never works.
Yeah, I'll tell you, you mentioned Gettleman, you shake your head. The two important draft picks he made were not good. I mean, you should have not used a second pick on Barkley, and you should not have used the sixth pick on Daniel Jones. I mean, it set the Giants back forever. It set them back forever. When you make a mistake on a quarterback like the Jets did with Zach Wilson, you know what the Jets did by picking Zach Wilson? They forced themselves to get into bed with Aaron Rodgers. Forced themselves.
Yep.
Just to get out from under it.
And you are so right, Michael, when you were using the comparison to Jones and to Wilson. The Giants get ignored because of the incompetency of the Jets.
Yep.
But if you look at the Giants and you look at the way the end of Eli's career was handled and the beginning of Daniel Jones' career, isn't it eerily similar? Oh, Eli's not a great quarterback. Look, he's embarrassing himself out there. He's not getting... Well, maybe the team, they didn't do anything around him. They made mistakes around him. Now, again, I think Eli was done. But boy, did they mess up the last 2-3 years of his career, and they certainly have messed up Daniel Jones' career up until Shane came in trying to clean up the mess. Michael, what an absolute mess post-Tom Coughlin this team has been. And really, honestly, post-Jerry Reese as well.
Yeah.
You know, Jerry Reese got fired. Nobody blinked an eye because they blamed him for all the offensive line problems. But look at what's happened since then. The hiring of Gettleman, the coaches that they hired, all to prop up Eli, all to try to get the most out of Daniel Jones, all just trying to get another kick at a championship. Boy, did they waste a good 5-6 years of embarrassing themselves, and it doesn't get as much play because the other team in town did worse.
Let's go to Jason in New Jersey. Jason.
Hey, guys. How's it going this morning?
Or good.
This afternoon, I guess, right?
How you doing?
What's up?
Hey, doing good. So, a couple things. I called in for a widget for Michael, but one more thing on the Caitlin Clark deal. The comp for men's and women's sports, Serena Williams. She's won more open championships than anybody in the sport, right?
Yep.
And nobody seemed to bat an eye about that. So,
they're not saying that she's better than Federer.
But again, no one... I don't think people say that about Caitlin Clark. They just say she has the most.
But the problem...
That's the argument we keep coming back to.
You know, there with women's golf, because of the tees being closer, and let's not forget, Serena Williams admitted that she couldn't beat most men, right?
She said she would not be able to.
But never mind that. You're not scoring the same. You don't play as many sets. Like, it's completely... It is apples and wrenches when you think of it. They're both playing tennis, but... It's a different world. I mean, imagine, but at least they're playing the same amount of minutes. The concept is the same with women's and men's basketball.
Same amount of minutes, different style of game, different size ball, things like that.
Mm-hmm. But it's not a different style of game, men's tennis to women's tennis. They play less sets.
But yeah, well, they play less sets in majors.
Well, they play sets in
majors.
Well, that's what you're grading everything on. Like, if she won the most majors, you would have to come with
correct.
A caveat
yes.
of...
Yes, that in those majors, she plays three sets, they play five. But the point is, No one says anything because no one cares because everyone knows. You don't have to say, well, Federer plays five sets. Djokovic plays. Everyone knows. I don't think anyone says anything. I mean, Serena Williams is the greatest tennis player of all time. And I think people would say, no, she's the greatest women's tennis player of all time. Novak Djokovic, greatest men's player of all time. Whoever you believe it to be, Federer. I think it'll end up being the same conversation with Caitlin Clark.
Let's shape-shift time. Mm. Let's say that Yamamoto signed with the Mets or the Yankees. Right? And right now he's pitching in spring training. Yamamoto pitched today in spring training. 3 innings, 6 hits, 3 walks, 5 earned runs. Would we do anything else on this show other than talk about how they wasted their money? How could you do that?
Well, did you hear what Buster said? That some people think it might take 2-3 years for him to get adjusted? I think that's an exaggeration. But I bet you take a knee on the first year. That you're not going to know how good he is in the first year.
Yankee fans would love that, by the way.
They like the slow cook.
Yeah. Slow, look, take a knee for the year. Let's see how it plays out.
Let's go to Mike in Manalapan. What's up, Mike?
Hi, Mike.
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Good. What's up?
Michael, I just wanted to... You said Aaron Rodgers is a specimen. Mm-hmm. In what sense is he a specimen? I mean, he got injured in the fourth play of one season. He's been injured in the past. His intellect has nothing to do with his athletic ability. He's never really shown himself as a specimen.
Well, I mean, but would you say he's one of the greatest quarterbacks of all time? So let's disregard the word specimen. Tom Brady wasn't a specimen.
That is true.
Well, I agree, but 4 years, I just don't think he's going to play that. I mean, maybe 1 year. When you said specimen, I thought you meant ability, like, to keep going. He's a great quarterback.
I think he's going to keep going.
So right now,
I think he's injured next year.
Yeah,
Well, you know what? Then you'll be right. If he's injured next year, you'll be right.
I hate guessing that way because it makes me feel like a bad guy. Because it's not what I'm rooting for. I want to watch this guy play. I love watching him play.
Could he have torn his ACL at 23? Of course he could. That same play could have happened. But I would bet
not his ACL. You mean
Achilles?
Right.
I bet you he'd have a way better chance of coming back at 24 than you do at 40.
But he was almost back at the end of the year.
Well, that's what he said.
No, but we saw a video of him, like, dropping back the pass and everything.
Yeah, but that's not playing in an NFL game, Michael.
Right,
he said he was going to come back, didn't come back. Now, I'm not going to kill him for it because he wanted so desperately to come back, but we still don't know what, at the age of 40, going to be 41 in December, how he is going to play because he'll still be 2 years removed from the last time he actually played an NFL game.
We come back with your phone calls. We find out who the point guard is for this Wednesday, rainy Wednesday. But first, we have to pay some bills and take a break here on Yes or 98.7 ESPN.
In an election year, our social media feeds can fill up with sensational claims and unfamiliar sources. And in the age of artificial intelligence, it's not hard to make a fake video look like the real deal. With so many tools, tactics, and motivations for spreading false content, we need to be on the lookout for bad actors looking to sway our votes. If you see a damaging post, image, or story about a candidate or issue, make sure to verify whether it's real or not before you share it. Falsehoods spread much faster than facts. Be informed, not misled.
The promise of America is freedom, equality. But right now, those pillars of our democracy are fragile. Reproductive rights, voting rights, the right to make your own choices and have your voice heard. We must act now to restore and protect these freedoms for us and for the future.
We are the American Civil Liberties Union, and we are fighting in every state, every day to defend your rights and the rights of all people.
We have got to be here. We've got to be strong to protect those rights.
For over 100 years, the ACLU has fought for everyone to have a voice and equal justice. And we will never stop, because we, the people, means all of us. To learn more about defending our democracy, go to myaclu.org today.
My dad, he's a double amputee, and he's one of my favorite people in the world. To me, a hero is someone who fights for our country and freedom.
My dad is a hero.
Those were our troops built this house, and it's basically made for him. My dad can get through the wide doorways. When he is making our lunch, he can reach anything we need. He'll help me build tiny projects. Life is good here. Without Homes for Our Troops, we'd be living in a home that didn't have all these features that helped him.
Homes for Our Troops builds and donates specially adapted custom homes nationwide for severely injured post-9/11 veterans and enables them to rebuild their lives.
If they get a new house like this one, it'll help them, like, do normal life.
My dad's not just a hero, he's my hero.
Join our mission at hfotusa.org.
The Library of Congress invites you to visit the revamped Veterans History Project website, where firsthand accounts shared by U.S. military veterans are accessible to the public. Performing a search of the collection is easy. First, go to loc.gov/vets. Click Explore the Collections. Scroll down to Search the VHP Collections and click. Make sure you're searching this collection, and with simple keywords, you can find what you're looking for. Visit loc.gov/vets today.
Chris Sheeran back here for the Michael K. Show. The Nets were down 8 in the fourth quarter to the Sixers, and this is when it all changed. Kenyon Martin Jr. with the reckless closeout on a Mikal Bridges 3, and he would hit all 3 free throws. That would cut it to 5, and then this 3 on the Nets' next possession by Dorian Finney-Smith cut the lead to 2. Brooklyn then took the lead on a Nick Claxton dunk and never trailed again. Thanks in part to the highest scoring fourth quarter of Finney-Smith's career, he poured in 12 and was key down the stretch for Brooklyn in their 5-point victory. He and Dennis Schroeder combined for 19 of the Nets' 32 points in the last stanza as the Nets finally got a win this season at home. After trailing through 3 quarters, they were an NBA worst 0-14 coming into last night's game. Interim head coach Kevin Ollie said his team needed a pack mentality before the game, and they responded. 5 of his players had 15 or more points, led by Schroeder and Finney-Smith, each netting 20 for the home team. And now the Nets hit the road for 10 of their next 11 away from Barclays Center, starting with a game in Detroit tomorrow night against the Pistons, who are currently tied with the Wizards for the worst record in the league. Both teams are the last teams in the NBA with a single digit in the win column. And both squads are in the net stretch of that 10 of 11 on the road. Our coverage tomorrow begins with the pregame at 6:30, followed by opening tip a little after 7:30. It's the Nets and the Pistons tomorrow night at 6:30, right here on YES.
It's a terrible choice. First of all, I never brought up about the woman wearing glasses, ever. Because the question was about Natalie. She doesn't wear glasses.
You know what?
It was about Peter wearing glasses.
Sort of like one of the stories we're going to get into during ENN. I'd like to file a complaint in tonight's point guard.
I think
I would like a review.
This is really strong. I don't think Anthony likes you. He never gives you the point guard.
I thought today.
Is that fair, Don?
Very fair.
Don't you think I think you guys would both agree there were a couple of moments today where you went, because think about it. The last couple of days, Michael has quoted me repeatedly, yet the things he quotes me for never get recognition in a point guard scenario.
That's because the guy judging doesn't like you.
But that's why I'd like to
follow. Thomas and Jacob hate you.
If I had to guess, I would say he likes you, but it's definitely on the table that he doesn't.
We'd go
to trial.
Can we file an appeal?
Well, first of all, I think he wants to, like, make nice to me. And second, he's Don's partner on a podcast. He wants to make nice to Don. He has nothing invested in you. Nothing. Am I right, Ant? Nothing invested in him.
I don't think. Look, the other option was Peter's point about Aaron Rodgers today.
That was the other option.
You gave it to Danny instead.
And you gave it to Danny. Really? What was my?
If you all three say point guard on a given time, there's a good to fair chance it's going to go.
Yeah, but
you're the one who said point guard about Danny.
I'd like to rescind when I said that.
Let's go to the earphones.
Look at me. Look how it's my first day with the glasses, with the lenses. I'm smarter than I've ever been. It's not right.
And technically, Jordan won yesterday, but we did give it to Don.
Let's go to Kevin in Corona. Kev?
Hey, what's up, guys?
How you doing?
Wow. I'm doing good, thanks. I've been trying to call into the show since I was like 13, and I turned 23 on Thursday.
Wow. Yes, love it. Happy birthday.
And you had to be this stoned for your first call?
Wow, he's not stoned. He's happy. He's relaxed.
No, he's stoned.
You guys know. I just wanted to say, Peter, yeah. Yo, thanks for making my early teen years, bro, on Hot 97. Yo, the morning show, you, Evo, Lord. And yo, being the DJ, like, those road trips before and after the baseball games, man, like, you made those happen, bro.
That's where you learned about Bavange.
I'm so glad that we taught you these things. You seem like a great kid, man.
Nah, so I want to ask a baseball question, right? About Trevor Bauer.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, Blake Snell, the Yankees have said, like, twice in the past month, we're not pencils down. We're still going to, you know, improve this team. And it's going on a week since supposedly they put the offer on the table for Snell.
No, it's over. So, it's over a month and a half.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, time's different when you're high.
Wasn't there a report that they are
before they signed Marcus Stroman. So they signed Marcus Stroman before spring training. Well before. And they offered, according, and I'm not sure of the numbers, but it's been reported 6 years, 150. And they didn't even get a reply from Boris and Snell camp. So they pivoted and they got Marcus Stroman. They're not interested in Snell. And also he was going to toke his way over to Bauer.
Was that a blunt?
Bauer is not, I mean, everybody's pencil is down on Bauer.
Had a little something, a little toke of the old Bubange.
It was skunk pop. Let's go to David in Rochester. David.
Smoke weed every day.
Wow, drugs must be great.
Hey, Michael.
Hello, David.
Hey, Michael. Quick question. Last year, Todd Frazier joined the Yes Analyst team. I saw him do some pregame, postgame, and then, like, he was gone, and there were no announcements made. Could you explain what's going on with Todd Frazier?
No, he's back. He's in the same role.
There you
okay,
go.
I didn't know. And Peter's same question about Kevin Patrick with WWE. From a fan's perspective, letting him go, it was stupid. Your opinion?
I love that you feel that way because Kevin is a good friend, and I think he's immensely talented.
K-Pat, they call him his friends, right?
No, KP. We just went with KP. Okay. Yeah. He's such a wonderful dude, and he. But it worked out really well because as his time was coming to an end there, he got the new in-studio host gig for all of Apple soccer coverage, which is a big deal. He's the guy on every Saturday on Apple. So, honestly, that's the fit for him. That's his A number one thing, doing commentary for soccer and hosting for soccer. So, I don't think KP was very sad to see this thing come to an end. I think he was ready. He gave wrestling a long run, but his heart, he's an Irishman. His heart's in soccer. This is what he always wanted to do, so.
Let's go to Anthony in Tampa. Hello, Ant.
Hey, guys. How's it going? I got a would you for you.
Okay.
My wife came up with this one.
All right.
So, would you rather, every time you go to a restaurant, you have to verbally insult the waiter to the extent that it ruins their day and they never forget about it the rest of their life, or every time you go to a restaurant, you have to lick the table you're sitting at, like a good 3-inch lick across the table.
I'd lick the table.
Yeah, lick the table. Well, they do a good job cleaning it. You hope, anyway.
Wasn't clean, if it was filthy and had all microbes.
I don't want to abuse
somebody. I hate making people feel bad.
Yeah. I thought Michael would love to abuse the waiter.
No, he wants to abuse his friends. No, Michael likes to be mean to me. You know, and other people he cares for. He doesn't want to be like,
I'll tell you why, Ann. You've truly hurt me and you've misjudged me.
No.
Because with people in the service industry, they don't have a greater friend than me.
Is that true?
Yeah.
Well, how much are you tipping these days?
25.
Yeah, you got to go up to 25, huh?
Yeah, 25 is...
Is that... You think it's...
And you know what? I'll give a clue to people that, like, wait on me. If they recognize me, you got to give more.
You got to give more.
Yeah, because then all of a sudden you're that guy. And just happened. Page 6 has it.
I like cubes.
Yeah, it just happened to me recently. Really expensive dinner, too. And I was like, oh, man, this tip. And then the guy was like, hey, man, just want to say... I grew up on all your interviews like Mac Miller and Tyler, the Creator.
You know, you should flip the table over right there. Flip the table over.
Why would I flip the table?
Because then they would have forgot about the Mac Miller stuff, and boom, you would have gotten... Nobody would, they would have said, wow, he lost his mind. Yeah. They wouldn't have said, oh, he only gave a 10% tip.
So wait, hold on. Isn't the whole point of the nice tip that you want people to say good things about you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but once they do the Mac Miller stuff, they pull on your heartstrings. There's no need to do that. You should have stiffed the guy.
Oh, that's a really, really interesting take by you. I don't agree with you at all.
No, you never do.
Well, no, this is just a bad take.
And how much did you tip at Clixie's?
Well, you didn't tip at Clixie's. You got the food at the counter and you sat yourself down.
You have to tip everywhere.
What was the typical meal at Clixie's?
Well, you had the Texas wieners, the hamburgers, hot dogs, fries.
So somebody's making them. You got to tip the
cook. No, but because it's kind of like you don't tip at McDonald's. You go to the counter, you order it, they give it to you, you sit down.
It's Netflix and chill.
One of my great conundrums every day, there's a bagel place where I live. Terrific bagels. And then you pay, you know, at the front, and it comes up, tip, 10%, 20%. And I'm going, what? You put bagels in a bag.
I think this is automatic on the machine.
But why should you even embarrass people like that?
I know. I kind of feel like it's a cliched conversation at this point because everyone's talking about this. What they've done, though, it's crazy. Everywhere I go, I have to now feel bad if I'm like, I don't want to tip you. I've never tipped for this. This is not built into...
It's crazy.
I mean, like...
And then in Europe, you don't have to tip at all.
They got it right, by the way. Pay the people a livable salary, and then if you feel like throwing them extra on top of their salary, you do it. But I go to a bagel place, because here's the thing. Then you start thinking about it, and you go, the bagel place, though, they really do work. I mean, especially if I, you know me. I'm a scooped-out bagel, and I want to toast it, I want this,
but
I want that.
But do you tip a guy who pumps gas into your car in Jersey?
They used to. My dad did when we were younger. Because whenever I got gas when we were young, because in Jersey, you didn't pump your own gas.
Right.
You got the full service. They checked your oil. They cleaned your windows without asking. My father would, you know, if it came out to like $23, give him $25 for the gas. But now they might ask if you want the windows. They never check your oil. Peter, there was a time you get gas when I was a kid. They check your oil. Then you're doing something.
But it is ridiculous. You're at a bagel place. They put like 4 low carb bagels in a bag, and
or an ice cream place. They give you a scoop of ice cream.
I mean, come on,
how much am I tipping for this bagel?
It's not fair. It's not fair to people.
Well, how about this? What about once you're doing the congestion pricing on top of it? You're paying $15 just to go 10 blocks.
How about
blocks?
The people that live in the congestion pricing area? They go, you're making me pay to go home. Think about that. There's no a caveat for that. So if you live below 60th Street in Manhattan, like you live on 59th, you have to pay every time you go home.
If you go up.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the same thing that I'm going
to
be doing.
No, you're paying for the right to drive. That's why they call it congestion pricing. They're trying to reduce traffic. They're telling you to go take the train.
But they shouldn't make people that live in that area. That's the only way you get home.
Even if you take a taxi
Uber, they have to pay more money.
Well, they're wanting you to take the train, and that's why the cops in the subway, because they're telling people to take the subway, it's one of the most dangerous places to be.
I have another theory about that.
I'd park on 60th, and I'd walk to wherever I have to go.
You would never, ever
get me to pay
to Union Square. You're going to walk?
I would walk, yeah. Or I take a train.
Because
the congestion pricing is more than the train would cost.
Every time that we... I'm going to basically just be changing my routine a lot, and most of my meals I'll end up finding places I like uptown, not downtown. But like, because you'll just naturally start being like, Dad, we feel like paying it's a random weeknight we're going to eat. Normally I might go, let's go to a place on 27th Street. Do I feel like
it? It's going
to
affect the parking garages that are in that area, because you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to drive, I'm going to take the bridge home, I guess, right?
Yeah.
Where we are, I'm just going to stay up upper side, and I'll take the bridge.
Wait, but you're fine. I thought coming from Jersey, he's fine.
No, he's not.
I thought that was the fight Jersey was making.
They're fighting it, but they're not going to win. They put it into the toll.
So if I enter from the Lincoln Tunnel and I'm in the 40s, then I got to pay.
When you come back?
When I come back, yeah.
I see, I thought if your Easy Pass, I assume what they would do is that if your Easy Pass had already done the trip from Jersey, you're now free once you're in the city. Well, not true.
I don't think so.
I don't.
By the way, isn't this the MTA is the state, right?
A couple of states, right?
No, no, but it's the MTA is run by the state, not by Eric Adams. And all the gambling stuff is also the state.
Right.
So real quick, we were surviving without gambling and without congestion pricing. Now they need the billion a year they'll get from gambling, plus they'll need the hundreds of millions from the congestion. What's going to happen?
Well, they said they'll get a billion from congestion.
Is it going to be the most beautiful? I mean, what is going to, is the train going to become like, it'll be like we're in Tokyo? What is going to happen with that money? They weren't making any money before. Now they get gambling money and congestion pricing?
And also, most of, Mayor Adams, his nighttime hangouts are downtown. Is he willing to pay for the congestion pricing? Come on.
And by the way, he has like a couple of, there are a couple of SUVs.
I told you my story about Cameron Maben and Mayor Adams.
He had no interest in you.
Yeah. He said to Cameron, give me your digits. He said, we had him on the air. We want to hang out. And I'm standing, I'm right here. You want my digits?
I got to tell you, I'm not going to talk to you because you won't be able to answer. I'm going to say to you, Don, it shows that Eric Adams, all due respect, is a hack-a-doodle-do. You would rather get the number of a Yankee who will be, with all due respect, his time as a Yankee will be a trivia question. No one will know he ever played here. And now he's not even part of the commentary team anymore.
Right.
To spurn the 30-year voice of the Yankees? That's a bad job. That's a bad job by the mayor in terms of having a good relationship. Where's Maben now?
Detroit. Right now, he's MLB Network.
Perfect. So anytime...
Cam's a great guy.
It's
not a diss to him at all. I think he's very good at what he does, too. But in terms of the mayor trying to build in New York City, great. And now you can go hang out at MLB Network in Jersey.
He doesn't hang out with me, Mayor. I've had mayors marry me, too. You know?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. The last mayor that sucked up to Michael, what happened?
You know what?
It might be one of the brightest things he's ever done.
You know what? I got to give Adams credit. Because the way things played out after that.
All right, we got ENN coming up. We're running late. Donna, tell us about pain.
All right.
When you see all the people who work at Schrader's Hospitals for Children, you might see everyday people just doing their job. But to me and other kids, they aren't just receptionists, therapists, or doctors. They're superheroes. But these superheroes are only able to help all of us kids because of the support of people just like you who empower their abilities so we get the care we need to live our lives like super kids.
Because of people like you, I can play the violin.
I can play piano.
And I can walk. Please go to loveshriners.org right away. Help us be superheroes too.
When disaster strikes, no matter where and when, cash is best. Those in crisis are able to decide where that money goes. It's easily exchanged and received across borders, and nobody knows the needs of a community in crisis better than the people within it. With cash, help goes exactly where it's needed, when it's needed. Ultimately, cash creates choice. And when it comes to what we should send to communities in need, our choice is simple.
The promise of America is freedom, equality. But right now, those pillars of our democracy are fragile. Reproductive rights, voting rights, the right to make your own choices and have your voice heard. We must act now to restore and protect these freedoms for us and for the future. We are the American Civil Liberties Union, and we are fighting in every state, every day to defend your rights and the rights of all people.
We have got to be here. We've got to be strong to protect those rights.
For over 100 years, the ACLU has fought for everyone to have a voice and equal justice. And we will never stop, because we, the people, means all of us. To learn more about defending our democracy, go to myaclu.org today.
My dad, he's a double amputee, and he's one of my favorite people in the world. To me, a hero is someone who fights for our country and freedom. My dad is a hero. Those were troops built this house, and it's basically made for him. My dad, we'd be living in a home that didn't have all these features that helped him.
Homes for Our Troops builds and donates specially adapted custom homes nationwide for severely injured post 9/11 veterans and enables them to rebuild their lives.
If they get a new house like this one, it'll help them, like, do normal life. My dad's not just a hero, he's my hero.
Join our mission at hfotusa.org.
When a child is sick, there's one thing they need: a really big cookie.
Welcome to RMHC.
And parents of sick children have tons of decisions to make. Like movie night, game night, or should we finish that book tonight? We don't perform surgeries, just talent shows. We're not big on poking sticks and beeping machines, but we're the best at playing dress up. But we have a few beeping machines. We think the tooth fairy should travel everywhere. And while hospitals have doctors and nurses, we have mom and dad. We don't provide treatment, but we do provide dogs. And we throw some really good parties. Because at Ronald McDonald House Charities,
we are home.
We help families feel at home, even when they can't be.
It's brought to you by Security Dodge. Go see Michelle Scalise.
Come get some!
Yeah!
I'd like to start off ENN tonight by saying good evening to Michael.
I produce dreams.
And to Michael and Don.
And now you see every curve and...
But Michael, relax. Please.
Oh, my God.
Save yourself. It's his wife.
And Don.
And me in a month. They'll get over it.
And to Don.
You're just a freak.
And to Don.
The whole fun is to feel your way around.
And to Don.
You guys don't know what you're doing. You have no game.
And to Michael and myself.
You have a baby. You're walking in the stroller with little Guadalupe in the stroller. And you're
walking, my 14th book.
You're walking.
Little Guadalupe in the stroller.
What a day.
Good evening to myself. There's meat here. There's girth. To Michael and myself.
I want to get Don and Peter's read on this, whether I'm getting soft. So.
Excuse me? And to the stoned caller from earlier who we enjoyed.
I've been trying to call into the show since I was like 13.
And you had to be this stoned for your first call?
Wow, he's not stoned. He's happy. He's relaxed.
No, he's stoned.
You guys know?
Yeah.
You guys know?
Now, here's the question. What's the better drop? The ha-ha you guys know or just the... I think the ha-ha you guys know, right?
Yes.
I think that'll be... I think that's where we should go forward with this thing. For a future play. Yeah, who knows? Who knows?
Coming up next Friday.
Next Friday.
Yeah, next Friday.
Now, I've been told that Anthony has decided to heed the advice that came his way from Don and myself, I believe, to include the other producers in the drop discussion.
Okay.
So he's now leading a committee. Is that right there?
And this
Yeah, I remember it specifically. Anthony, you're really bad at this. What you really need to do is bring in Jacob and Tom.
That's unfortunate. Why wouldn't you be more well-rounded? Take a little pressure off of you. We've got very talented, creative people around you. So
Tom's been doing the work. Jacob. I've seen them.
Tom, Jacob.
Jingleheimer Schmidt.
Oh, wow. His name is my name. Oh, that's scary.
All three of us.
We all came up with the same line.
Or Renew. One of the two.
I think it split up.
That's the way you look at it?
Interesting.
I mean, when we start to say the same thing, I mean, it's easy for the company to pair off somebody and save money.
So, obviously, you're the seller, so.
Yeah, really. I mean, we got nothing to worry
about. Let's keep marching into the future.
I'm the what?
You're the money.
You're the transmitter and the salary.
Yeah.
And the show.
You're just a freak.
Did you see this Phil Hughes tweet?
Yeah. Take me through it. I didn't hear it.
I just read it.
That's weird. Okay. Something's been really bothering me lately. When did we stop speaking with a British accent? Founding fathers undoubtedly spoke with one, as did their kids and their kids, presumably. When did the chain break? I'm torn up.
That's a question that somebody, I think Phil Hughes is high. That's a question you ask when you're high. I mean, Phil, it was 250 years ago. I'm sure, you know, over time.
Yeah, that's how.
I'm surprised we haven't grown like a fin since then. I mean, it's
a really good point by Don. The fin thing is a really good thing.
Right. When will we grow a fin?
Yeah, soon.
Do you know? Ballard's lovely partner Katie had such a great compliment of Don the other day.
Oh, really?
Yeah, she said she loves Don, and she said she'll often be in the other room and hear the show, and whenever she hears Don, he's always something that's like saying something that's very measured and reasonable.
Don?
That's right.
I've heard that.
It's Katie Stone, too.
No,
right?
No. Not as not
well, first of all, why is she dating Ballard?
Oh, you've said this every time. I mean, I can't answer that, but she's not stoned. Very stoned.
I think she's as stoned as our previous caller.
No.
Yeah.
No. Not her style. No.
When Ballard asked her out, this was her first reaction.
You're jealous that someone thinks Don is thoughtful and measured.
Well, listen, I think Don's a terrific broadcaster. Thoughtful and measured is not how I would describe him.
Well, then you're insulting me.
When he's screaming at Crane Pool, is that
is that who I am? When we sometimes go months between rants,
that's all part of who you are.
All right, yeah, but you don't also think a part of who I am is that I have thoughtful answers and that I
am not
really.
I'm not on board.
But I have heard that compliment before.
I'm sorry that I'm passionate.
I think Katie is indulging in hallucinogenics.
Let's go with Don.
Yeah, very thoughtful and measured.
I hope he does right.
How about when he broke the computer?
Punch him right in the face.
Is that thoughtful and measured? Is that thoughtful and measured?
This computer.
This is not a good look for Michael.
No, it's bad.
It's a bad look for Katie.
Look at this garbage.
So again,
by the way, she's not the only one who feels this way.
Who else?
The listeners love Don.
They love Don for his lunacy.
You think they think he's a yo-yo monkey boy, and he just does dances on the TV with a cymbal. That's all you think he is.
I believe he's an unbelievable broadcaster. He's great at this. He's not thoughtful and measured.
Oh, you know what?
I think I am.
You guys know.
I think Katie's out of her mind, frankly.
He's dead.
Katie.
Swap aside!
Katie Ballard.
This is my good friend. I'd prefer you not.
Katie's not your good friend.
Yes, she is.
She's your good friend through Ballard.
Well, you don't know.
If Ballard broke up with her tomorrow, you'd never have anything to do with her again.
That's a whole other discussion.
Well, hold on.
It's guilt by association.
She's friendship by association.
So, real quick, you do not consider Mike Breen's wife a friend?
Yes, I do.
Okay, but
God forbid if they broke up, I don't know if I'd have much contact with
them. So do you consider a friend or not?
Yes, I do.
Then I rest my case. It's so nice to get a clean win like that.
Just it's a not clean win. I'm going to tell you why it's win. Not a clean. They've been married for 30 years.
It doesn't matter.
Katie and Ballard have been hooking up for what, a couple of weeks?
No, years. As long as me and Natalie.
I didn't see Katie at the wedding, did I?
Yeah, you did.
You just didn't care.
I was not introduced to Katie.
Well, maybe that's because people didn't think you were worthy of such a meeting. But
well,
you know
what? Ebro was. I'm fine.
Don.
Your sister-in-law with the bad handshake, she was very intrigued in meeting
Ebro's.
I won the argument.
You did not.
The point is, yes, your friendships with your friends' wives do hinge on that relationship to a certain degree, a major degree. That doesn't make them not dear friends.
Let me really dive down here. You were married before this. Mm-hmm. Are you friends with your ex-wife's friends? Or have they remained close with you? Or do they look at you like you're human garbage?
I don't think the first is not true, but I don't believe the second to be true either. They still follow me on social media.
But you're not hanging out with them.
No,
it could be true where you could be friends with your friend's significant other, but then the collateral damage of a breakup.
Right. One of the hard things about
that's what I'm
together.
Saying. God forbid that beautiful couple that people dream of, Katie and Ballard, if they break
what
up, he'll never hear from Katie again.
But that doesn't. And if Mike Breen and his wife, God forbid, break up,
right,
it'll be the exact same thing. Yet you consider her a friend just like I consider Katie a friend, a real friend. Well, I don't have that many friends. Natalie and I only socialize with so many people. Literally, we have a handful of friends we get together with for dinner.
If you really break it down, honestly. How many friends does anybody have?
I don't even want friends.
It's funny. I have a million friends, and I have about three couples that I actually like, hey, want to grab dinner? That we grab dinners with. That come to our home.
Especially now with the guy. Like, it's John Stark's birthday today. Happy birthday, John Stark.
The great New York Nick.
Yeah, and I text him, and he texts me on my birthday. I don't know. I haven't seen him in like a year. I mean, it's like post, you know, with COVID and just the kids. I mean, we're still friends, but like, how many people do you really honestly say?
Exactly.
But you know what? As I get older, I'm pruning the tree because most friends want favors. Yankee tickets, can you donate to this? I don't want friends.
Another more my wife is my friend. Guy. You don't actually prune the tree.
I do prune the tree.
No, but life kind of goes on and you kind of grow apart from each other.
Right.
But you don't sit there and go, I'm not going to be friends with anymore.
Oh, I've done that.
Goodbye.
No, that's a bad guy. I'm close friends with the people I went to college with. Those are my forever friends.
I don't think
and you two guys too.
Oh, thank you.
Well, thanks for the favor.
Do you ever just sit there, Don, and just look at John Stark and go, that last game against Houston? Did you ever meet John?
Michael has. I don't know if he remembers him at all.
No, I do.
You wouldn't think basketball.
No.
No, you wouldn't think. This polar opposite of John Stark.
You have 8.5 minutes left in the NN.
He'll make it work. This is the NN.
Don't you know? Let's hear from Tom Thibodeau.
Let's get back to sports. Oh, my God. Dear Heavenly Father.
No, we're okay with that. Go on.
Yeah, let's move on.
We've done the Knicks today.
Yeah, we're good.
You don't want to hear an update?
No, I don't.
It's on Jalen Brunson.
No, he's fine. MRA was good. Let's go. Let's go.
How about, let me hear something, Michael. This Michael's going to be visibly excited for this, Don. Do you want to hear Carlos Rodon analyzing his...
You know what? We haven't talked about that. Why don't you have
him? He had a bad outing today.
Let's see what he says.
He was not good today.
All right,
two home runs.
Go.
Not what you want.
Well, the results weren't everything I wanted, but mixed in a good amount of pitches. I think we worked in some changeups, some cutters, through some curveballs, and a lot of heavy dosage of sliders. You know, it was good to see some swing and miss on the cutter, some weak ground balls in the cutter. Fastball wasn't exactly where I wanted it to be, but that's a part of these spring training games.
I would love a slider right now.
You guys know.
Thank you. That was a good bit of information.
You said no before because it's March. But you shouldn't be especially after what happened last season.
Not even a bit.
So let's not bother. I'll see you on opening day.
To what goes on in spring training.
Oh, but then that should also go for Juan Soto.
Yeah.
But, I get a home run every at bat. Doesn't matter.
You know what?
Either I care or don't care. I can't parachute in.
No, this is big.
So you don't care. You know you don't care about spring training results.
I don't, but I also don't want it to be a la carte.
Breaking news.
Well, Soto's
breaking news. Gravy shot tomorrow.
The armorer. Who loaded the live round into Alec Baldwin's gun on the set of Rust was found guilty of involuntary manslaughter.
Well, makes sense.
So, I mean, are they letting Alec Baldwin finally
off the hook?
I mean, really, listen, whatever you might think of Alec Baldwin and his politics, or you think the guy...
I don't like him. I don't like him at all.
You believe that the guy actually killed that woman.
I know.
I mean, to put that guy through that, for what reason? Just for the publicity?
Well, by the way, he already has to deal with... That it happened.
Right. He'll never forget that. He killed somebody by accident.
The emotional turmoil he's already going to go through from that, and he had to go through a second trial, a whole thing.
It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. Whether you hate him or like him or you're indifferent, that you really think that guy killed that person on purpose.
I saw a little feature about it recently, the case, and the woman who was found guilty,
mm-hmm.
her argument, A, she tried to throw him under the bus.
Yeah.
But she also... said that basically she was given way too much to do, and she had told the movie, I'm not capable of doing what you're asking me to do. It's too much. But I think ultimately what it probably came down to is there was just no reason to ever have live rounds on a set.
Yeah, why would you ever put bullets into a...
No, why would they even be there? They should not even... The idea that a live round existed anywhere there... That alone is, to me, I'd be like, all right, good night, good luck, that's it.
And you think Alec Baldwin wanted, you know, to
play around with a gun.
Right. Come on, man. Again, to me, everything in life now is political.
I know.
That's a politically tinged
the whole thing.
Thing.
I don't like him. I don't like him a bit. Never did. I prefer Billy. Billy Baldwin, the best Baldwin. Stephen Baldwin, very handsome, good-looking Baldwin.
Biodome.
My high school girlfriend, Diana, loved Stephen Baldwin. He was her, like, dream crush.
How could you love Stephen Baldwin more than Alec? When Alec was young, He was the best looking Baldwin.
But Steven's younger than Alec.
Yeah. Yeah, but when you looked at Alec and
but when I was in high school,
and
Alec,
Beetlejuice.
But when I looked at Alec when I was in high school, how old is Alec Baldwin right now?
He's got to be in his 60s.
Hey Siri, how old is Alec Baldwin? He is 65. He said he'll be 53 on Saturday. So he's 65 now. So 30 years ago, when I was in high school, 30 years ago when I was a freshman, and Diane and I started dating, and she loved Stephen Baldwin, he was 35 then, whereas Stephen then was probably, what, like 26?
He's still better looking at 35.
He felt like a dad already. He was giving dad vibes already.
There was kind of a coolness. A great top five, you would really have to like
Baldwin.
Really get
top
down.
Five Baldwin.
Because Haley right now, she's number one.
Gap.
Hot Haley, that's what we call her.
Gaps between movies. I mean, Stephen Baldwin was in Biodome and Usual Suspects.
Yeah.
I mean, that's quite the gap.
Well, but in retrospect, it's, oh, in quality. Yeah.
I believe that I'm going to wear the Alec Baldwin Beetlejuice outfit tomorrow. The black and white check shirt.
Interesting.
Oh, nice. Yeah, I'm going to do that.
You know what I found interesting in our movie conversation we were having for the our social media accounts here at 98.7 ESPN New York was about, you know, best movies as we're preparing for the Oscars this weekend. Found it interesting. I almost went with American Beauty.
Mm-hmm.
I ended up showing love to Spike Lee and going with Do the Right Thing. But Usual Suspects was chosen by another one of the hosts, and it made me think. Kevin Spacey, a bit of a fall from grace, to say the least, but reasonably has two of the great movies of modern history.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty impressive. Yeah. And then he had a TV show that was,
which was
for a while, was unbelievable.
Which was unbelievable cards, fiction and turned out to be a documentary.
It wasn't that bad. I don't believe...
Really?
I don't believe that anyone in a recent administration... in any recent administration was... shoving people into train tracks.
Okay, so when
I'm going to give them
when House of Cards came out,
yeah,
and you're probably thinking, I mean, this is so far fetched. Whether you think recent administration or not, what you've seen in politics now, is it far fetched
that anything's possible?
That anything like what happened in House of Cards could happen? Come on, be honest.
I am. I'm going to be honest. I'm going to be honest. People would expect me to say one thing. The truth is, if you remember the depths that it went to,
I thought that show was unbelievable. To kill
the woman,
yeah,
to cover up the first woman gets killed,
mm-hmm.
but then there's the later. Don't they end up killing the other woman too?
Yes.
I know this. I know there are people who think they align with me politically who are going to be disappointed that I feel this way. I don't know if I think anyone's capable of that.
I do.
Murder.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Maybe it's the level of hands dirtiness. Maybe I think it's possible, but I don't think the hands would be so dirty.
Well, it might be like...
Where their administrative assistant...
Like
what was the guy's
six
name?
6 degrees of Kevin Bacon, yeah.
Yeah, it'd be a little more removed.
Right.
In that show...
Right.
What's his face? The bald guy. Yeah. He's literally running through the desert, like, by himself, trying to kill this lady.
Right.
That show... Don, did you ever watch it?
No.
Oh, it was terrific.
Don, I still can. I think you should.
I never saw the end of it. Like, after he left the show, I never saw, like, Robin Wright become president. I never saw that. Did you?
I don't think I watched the last season.
Yeah, I didn't watch the last season.
You know what happened? Because he was kicked off the show.
Right. And they made her president.
And I think I was so turned off by the stuff that was said about Kevin Spacey, I don't think I watched the last season.
Yeah, well, he wasn't in the last season.
I should go back and watch.
Do it.
I think it was Vape Ape times, too.
No, I'm not.
I missed a lot during the Vape Ape.
You missed a lot? You missed
a lot? Would I be captivated? Would this go like Breaking Bad kind of way for
early
me?
Early on.
It was so good.
You will, if early on, if you start watching one a day, you're going to come in going,
first
oh,
two
my,
seasons
God.
Were,
oh
will,
my God.
Oh my God. You might watch them in a row.
Yeah, the
you
first two seasons are just gorgeous. Right. I mean, so intensely fun to watch. That'll do it
wow.
for ENN.
Not a lot, but a lot.
Right, not a lot, but a lot. It was brought to you by Security Dodge Shop 24/7 at securitydodge.com. And during their Dodge Power Shot Days Jeep Celebration event, Ram and Truck Month.
You didn't even tell about the
damn it, the high school game.
High school game.
I had a whole.
In Jersey.
Do we have 30 seconds? Do it.
Just air it. Let it stand on its own.
I am so disgusted by what happened
to
this game.
A winning shot was waved off by the officials, and it was clearly good.
Yes.
Change the championship.
It was really, really disturbing. The Camden, how do you say Manasquan versus Camden, and Manasquan got robbed. It's an absolute disgrace. The ball was 100%
out of this kid's hands.
It was the last play. It was, they.
That's a wrap on the show for today. Coming up next, Yankees Magazine, followed by an encore presentation of the game earlier today between the Yankees and the Rays. For all of us here on the Michael Kay Show, this is Chris Sheeran saying have a great night. We'll see you again tomorrow at 3 o'clock.
Consider myself the luckiest man on the face of the earth.
Playing in Yankee Stadium is the best thing that could ever happen to a ball player.
It's a huge honor to put this